Hey, this is Nola Ade. You are now rocking with Ill McKenzie right here.
Boy Gabe, but I want to give a big shout out to Quarantine Radio. Make sure you check them out every Tuesday and every Thursday. And thank you for supporting my new single, Down Low.
I want to hear that new soulful wisdom on Quarantine Radio.
Yo, what's up, man? It's the Kid Swift, a baby, Young Swift. One time for the check-in with my dog, my homie, Ill McKenzie, straight out of ATL, Georgia. And you know how we rocking out here, baby. Let's get it.
Tried being humble, humble get no respect.
Yes, it's your boy iDub once again with another edition of Quarantine Radio. Our guest Madison Jay, he actually just told me that he's on his way. So we're just going to go into a couple of things. I just wanted to let y'all know, if y'all been following me on Instagram, Facebook, if you actually like the Quarantine Enterprise fan page, you probably already seen an event that I'm actually helping out on. It's actually like if you're an entrepreneur into business or anything that might interest you, it's actually a business speed dating event. I know a lot of people heard about speed dating events, but this is actually a business speed dating event. So like business owners, business supporters, business innovators, you can come to this event. You can go to let me make sure I got the address for togetheriseverything.net/event, and you can get your tickets that way. So if you're a business owner or just somebody that's trying to get into a business, you can come to that event. Link up, network. It's a real good networking event. If y'all remember last year, I actually interviewed Ty on the show about his website, Together is Everything, and he explained what the purpose is and why he's actually doing what he's doing to help business and entrepreneurs just get their brand out there, kind of like what we do on this show and everything. So if you, like I said, this is probably an event that you want to be part of, and I just realized I did not give y'all the date of it, but it is November 10th is going to be in Durham, North Carolina, the Aloft Hotel. If you are familiar with downtown and you see the Aloft Hotel, that's where it's going to be, right in that that little bar area at the Aloft Hotel and everything. So other than that, like, we got a couple things that's going on quarantineenterprise.com. Got a couple reviews that we did. I might do a couple more reviews. I just started doing movie reviews, so be on the lookout for that. I actually did the review for the movie Venom.
Great movie.
Yeah, and I actually found out, well, it's not really, but I didn't stay long enough. I found out there was a scene after the whole credits. Like, I saw the mid one. But the one after, well, I'm not going to ruin it for people, but it's not really too big of a deal. That's all I'm going to say about that. But if you see to my left, you see that we finally got graced with the presence of Joy. How you doing today?
Yo, what's up?
And we got King Cancer to my right.
What up?
Alright, so like I said, we're going to have Madison Jay on the show. He's like I said, he's about to be on his way. So we're going to play some music while we're waiting on him. First track that I'm about to play is Snipe Luciano with Feel the Vibe. This is Snipe Luciano with Feel the Vibe, alright?
Whatever you do, don't blow my buzz or my high. I'm trying to feel the vibes. I feel the vibes. Whatever you do, don't blow my buzz or my high. I feel the vibes. I feel the vibes.
a young little tricky Mickey Ficky spitting raps, talking about the trap cats and some of this and some of that. I started off like 1-2, microphone check, 1-2, mic check. I'm about to catch rap. Give me the mic, I'm nicer than any in sight. Running around you in the circle, used to flow till I turn purple. Now I just lay in the cut, drinking champagne and smoking purple. The chronic for the mind, I'm drinking mimosas for the vocals. I'm popping like Cristal in 96, let's get it. It's a celebration. If vigilante click is the confederation, we growing by the day. These niggas that he hating. I need a vacation for meditation, medicating THD. This ain't a regular vape. I realize I'm ahead of the race. They running in place. Logan, I'm not your peer. You're not in my space, not in my zone. You ain't seen what I seen. I live what I speak, so I say what I mean. I mean what I say, so when I say that I mean, I murder tracks all season. Believe it.
Whatever you do, don't blow my buzz or my high. I feel the vibe. I feel the vibes. Whatever you do, don't blow my buzz or my high. I feel the vibes. I feel the vibes.
Drum on the stick, hey, I'm tryna be like a kid, yeah. I caught the whip with the kids, she take off her clothes like they don't fit, yeah. Young, tall, and skinny, I'm fit, tattoo my body, I'm lit, yeah. Tatted her head to my toes, let it shout on all of my foes. Get the bag, get it, I never let go. Get the bag, get it, I never let go. Get the bag, get it, I never let go. Get it back, get it, I never let go. Take a number, stand in line, I give you the hood you want. Green light, Steph Curry, I can let go when I walk. Give me my change, please, just give me my change. They love you so much when you broke, well I'm sorry I changed. Change of plans, I heard your mans was changed. I made the bank deposits like I am Dizzy Grams. I put a V on my mask, I put a mask on my neck. No, I'm not talking computers, when I say I'm good with my tech. I got the white like I'm Czechoslovakian, truck in the front, but I still throw the body in. Trigger as light as a bobby pin. Yeah, I cut the girl like cesarean. I push the horse like a chariot. This Chino Hills with the cherry pink. Ballin', ayy, drum on the stick. I'm tryna be like a kid. Yeah, I cut the whip with the kids. She take off her clothes like they don't fit. Yeah, young, tall, and skinny, I'm fit. Tats on my body, I'm lit. Yeah. Tatted up, head to my toes. I did this shit on all of my foes. Get the bag, get it, I never let go. Get the bag, get it, I never let go. Get the bag, get it, I never let go. Get the bag, get it, I never let go. Dynamite, baby, I'm poppin'. Yo, Willie be running option. Over the pop with concussions. Wrist automatic and caution. Fully automatics at the concert. Buckin' knockin' in the guy is Converse. Couldn't talk and I ain't tryna converse. This a felon rapping, this a Converse. That is a barbic fella. I'm on a barbic fella. Yeah, still rolling the out the jar, big fella. Ooh, he weak. Ooh, get us some milk. Ooh, ooh, let's shout to your baby mama. To me, she a milf. My money is dirty like filth. Yeah, my whippy go skirt like a kilt. I'm from the dirt like a silk. Yeah, I pour up a four and no smilk. Tough like a four, how I'm built. Yeah, I'm on a hundred like Will. Yeah, your OG is soft in the silk. Whoa, I spray the banana and peel like rah, 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 rah. Hey, Jay, pass me another drum. I ain't done. Dynamite, sauce. Hey, look, drum on the stick. Hey, I'm trying to be like a kid. Yeah, I cut the whip with the kids. You take off the clothes like they don't fit. Yeah, young, tall, and skinny, I'm fit. Yeah, tats on my body, I'm lit. Yeah, tatted her head to my toes. With the shot on all of my foes. I shit it, get it, get it, get it, I never let go. Get it, get it, I never let go. Get it, get it. Keep cooking, so hot.
Dynamite.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Young Swift. Bull City thing. Talking about. Yeah. Yeah. It's gonna. Look. Back to back Mozzies. Glenn Fittich your side of Mozzie. I travel off. But keep the city deep inside me, I am Durham Golly. These young boys catching bodies over pennies probably. Pray for them, Allah got me, I was born a Baptist. But moved on to higher practice, I'm learning though. 48 laws is only half of my Mardi Gras. Since the days of Donna Karen, I was born a rapper. Give all honor to my parents that we never be. Ish, but we made it better than everything. Only ever dreamed to be Bull City celebrities. And now we global, shows in places I could never see. Came a long way from fried chicken wings to Stephanie's. My destiny, I guess, was to be Bull City now. They don't understand, I'm one of Bull City's gods. Started in the city, yet we took it so far. Now everywhere I go, they throw them bulls in the crowd.
Some build and destroy, we build and build up. Get bills, that bills up, don't gas me, I'm filled up. I probably hit the gas, get gas and peel blunts. Then ride through the city with gunner, no runners up. This is first place, worst case scenario. They seeing me, I see you at your burial. Look, I'm a flawed man, but these diamonds is flawless. Everything else, I'm trying to work out like CrossFit. Poor little Paulin' dog, I'm feeling vindicated. It's better renovated. Look, that never been debated. I'm 2.0, you must know. For I believe it, it's certain that you must show.
You must show.
No cap, I'm going Kaepernick. Leave you kneeling at my feet and defeat. You asked for this. Bags under my eyes, I got bags to get. Got up in the mix, now I done mastered it. Swift.
How you living on your block?
Mine's is hot. How you living on your block?
I got it locked. What's going down on your side? Who got shot?
Same shit, bruh.
Yeah, that's right, I meet you up top.
Hey, yo, it's hard to shake this feeling that I might get knocked.
Bruh, you know it don't stop. We can't close up shop.
Come on.
It's gonna, VVS's, only shopping with TLS and we don't speak confessions. Die with it, but keep the essence, say the streets depressing. But me and Swift are speaking blessings for the people section. Share blood where we reppin'.
I'm an original medicinal puffer, Dutch stuffer, plus hustler, get the cream and touch butter. Everything changed when I did numbers, spend summers, reminding you, you been front us.
It's gonna and Swiffer, spring, summer, the winter, winter, the fall. You doubt it, so we killing y'all all. Envision the gods and custom made, limited cars. Spit it in sickest, cause you wish you could twist it in cigars.
Living with no regard, before I had a frame, look, I could picture it all. And now we fully involved, money ties untied, still I got a money knot. I had to go and get it, everything they want I got.
How you living on your block?
Mine's is hot. How you living on your block?
I got it locked. What's going down on your side? Who got shot?
Same shit, bruh.
Yeah, that's right, I meet you up top.
Ayo, it's hard to shake this feeling that I might get knocked.
Bruh, you know it don't stop. We can't close up shop.
Come on.
Yeah. It's gonna. Swift.
Yeah.
919.
No. Yes, sir.
Canes, home of the hills, home of the pack, watch it's attack. Slide through the cut, my nigga was good, they think cause I'm proper. That Madison Jay, ain't come from the hood, I stroll through the R. I holla at Petey, holla at Two, holla at Kizzy. I know she gon' probably be mixed with the crew. Holla at Shice, holla at Black, holla at News, holla at Mez, holla at Rome, nigga we own, yeah. Holla at Ola, holla at Mills, who's chasing that check, ain't for the neck. Applying the pressures, I only do best. I'm rocking with Pooh, I holla at Ruger, I'm raising the bar. Got love for the city, hey, this be the R, this who we are, yes.
I've been waiting for my day to come, so now I feel it's my time to shine. I've been waiting for my day to come, so now I feel it's my time to shine, yeah. We ready, yeah, we ready, yeah, we ready for what you said that.
feel like I'm home. End of my zone, I usher him in. But we ain't got time for lovers and friends, immaculate pen. If they pull it out, I might detonate. Rap crowds, I separate. Gotta stay around from these f***ing fakes. I legendary, and this is just the debut. Labels try to enslave you. I'm so in tune with the matrix. Took it back to the basics. Mingled with all the races. Take my name, elevate it. This week is called elevation. Okay, everything's cool. Just watch how you move. When we enter the groove, whatever you choose. You shoot for the stars, then you aiming to lose. Hey. I done waited 20-something-odd years for this. Counting for life. That explains why I kill for this. Yes!
I've been waiting for my day to come. So now I feel it's my time to shine. I've been waiting for my day to come. So now I feel it's my time to shine. Yeah, we ready. Yeah, we ready. Yeah, we ready. Who was who said that?
Come up and show to our world why I'm next for the crown. Gave her the tapes. I've just been working. The master of the sound, master of the craft. You would have thought I was plotting with masons. Growing impatient. Think of the minutes and seconds I wasted. The practice is ancient. Started my day with the waking and bacon. Hey, here go the flow. Hey, give me your ears and even exchange. Oh Lord, I hope I don't fall from this game. I'm trying, I'm trying, I'm trying to make my way. Salute to my fam, I am what I am. You encourage a man, I hatching a plan. We let it unfold, got glue on our hands. They ain't get it, I push the limit, sick of with it. Pictures I orchestrated, illustrated, hope you get it, yes!
I've been waiting for my day to come, so now I feel it's my time to shine. I've been waiting for my day to come, so now I feel it's my time to shine, yeah. We ready, yeah, we ready, yeah, we ready. Who was who said that we won, yeah? We ready, yeah, we ready, yeah, we ready. Who was who said that we won?
Alright, we're back. We're still waiting on our guest to come. While we're waiting on him, we're just going to talk about a couple current events that's been going on around the country and everything. One of the things that I was trying to touch on Tuesday that we didn't actually get an opportunity to touch on, there's actually two more insert name, just black people living their life and something. The one, I forgot what they call it, the apartment girl, but she's basically saying that she's not racist and her soon-to-be ex-husband is actually black. She actually lost her job over this whole situation. Did you guys saw that video?
Yeah.
You didn't see the video? So what happened is that this man was trying to get into his apartment, and the woman said that she didn't recognize him and was questioning does he live there and stuff like that, and basically wouldn't allow him into the building because she claimed that he did not live there.
Yeah, and she then asking her, let me see your key card. Who are you here to see? Because you don't obviously live here, so you're here to visit somebody. So who are you here to visit? Why are you here? And she was letting her dog use the bathroom.
But some people are saying that they think that she was on the low trying to holler at him because, like, if she felt uncomfortable, why would she follow this man into the elevator that she was uncomfortable with?
Yeah, exactly. Then she followed him. Yeah. Then she followed him all the way to his apartment.
Yeah. So some people thought she was trying to shoot her shot on the low and everything.
But
she actually did an interview. I heard part of the interview, and she was like, she was just doing her duties and what people in the apartment complex told her to do and stuff like that. Saying that she was just unaware. But I feel like if she honestly wanted to actually see if the guy lived there, all she had to do was walk away, close the door behind her, and let the man use his key card. Like, she didn't have to block his interest and stuff like that and keep on questioning him. That was the whole thing, is that because the way that the video looked, like, and then she's still following him and still questioning him, like, he could not live there. That's basically the way that she was acting. It's like there's no possible way that he could live in that type of environment.
Well, my first question would be, for her to even do that to him, do you do this to everybody that you see coming in or coming into that apartment? Are you there every day stopping people? I don't know you. You don't look like you live here. Do you live here regardless of if they're black, white, Hispanic, whatever, male, female? Are you doing this to everybody? Because if you're doing this to everybody, that's a problem, first of all, because she didn't work at this apartment complex. She was just living there. She worked at another apartment complex. But where this happened, she didn't work there. She just lived there. So if she wants to say, well, I'm doing my due diligence as a resident of this apartment complex, are you doing, like, again, are you doing this to everybody?
I mean, did something recently happen, maybe? Because I don't see why anyone would just have all those questions for them, just walking up there. Exactly. So maybe they had an incident or something.
No, there was no incident report or anything. Like, the guy actually, he actually did a, like a live stream and everything. And then one of the people that is on my Facebook friend list actually was friends with him and everything. And they were talking about it as well. So ain't no telling. But the other person, the other situation that somebody's saying that they can't hear. But I'm having I have the volume all the way up. So I'm not 100% sure. Cause I'm showing that everything's flowing. Let's see if somebody else says something. But over here it's showing that I have volume and everything. Hold on, let me test one more thing. Testing. Yep. So I'm not sure exactly what's going on with the Facebook feed, but yeah, it is showing that volume is going, and I just did the monitor thing. So the other thing that happened actually was the convenience store. I think they said convenience store Sally.
Oh, no, corner store Caroline.
Corner store Caroline. Yeah.
Yeah, convenience store. The name's got to start with the same letter. Every name that these people are giving,
I don't know. It's just so many names and everything. But this woman, like in the video, the woman is over the counter. I guess she's about to purchase something. A little boy walks by with his book bag. The book bag brushes against her butt. She start hollering, "That little boy tried to grab my ass."
I did see that one.
First of all, I was looking at her like, first of all, who wants to even grab your behind?
See, Brian, why you being picky? You can't be doing that. Come on.
What
now.
You mean? I'm not, no. You're
trying to get this little boy for a violation. Teach him while they're young.
Look, man, look, he's smart. He ain't want to touch that.
You don't know. He just sees something grabbable and just grab him something.
She ain't got nothing grabbable back there. I guarantee you, it's flat as a piece of paper.
Brian, you need to stop. You need to stop.
I guarantee you.
But yeah, so
this little boy probably tried to move out of her way because he probably saw it and was probably just like, "I don't want to touch this."
Didn't have any space to move.
And his book bag just grazed her behind, and she flipped out.
She did apologize for that, right?
Yeah, she ended up apologizing, but the way that she went about it, like she was arguing with the mother, telling her that he had no respect. The little boy was there crying and everything.
And his little
sister was crying. Yeah, they were there crying. I couldn't see if the dad was there, but they were calling for their dad and everything. And the woman plain and said, because like when she apologized, she said she did not say that she was a cop, but it's plain in the video. You can hear her say, "I'm a cop." Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know why she said that in the video, but then again, like, when she was apologized, I never said that. But there's video evidence of you saying that. So, like, I just didn't understand, like, what was her logic, and, like, was she just having a bad day? But it's just crazy, like, every week something like this happens, and, like, this little boy, like, he's probably traumatized. For the rest of his life and everything.
Every white woman he come close to, he gonna make sure he about 10 feet away from them. Because he
probably won't even remember that when he get older. Oh, he'll block it all out.
They ain't going to let him
forget that. He's 9 years old.
The world is not going to let him forget that.
Like, I could see if, like, he was younger than, but 9 years old, they're going to remember stuff like that.
I mean, like that, that's gonna... what does she want? A lawsuit?
She called the cops and everything.
Well, Dixie, and that's the thing. The cops never showed up.
The cops can't do nothing with a 9-year-old boy.
So she was claiming that she was on the phone talking about some, get a cop down here. Excuse me. I was harassed. I was sexually harassed by a little boy. Cops never showed up, so no one ever. So at this point, we don't know if she actually did call the cops. Or she was just faking that whole part about being on the phone with the cops because nobody ever showed up.
But Brian, imagine you being a cop and somebody's on the phone saying, this 9-year-old grabbed my butt.
I mean, if you call the cops, they're still going to show up.
Yeah, they're going to show up. Because there are a couple times that they showed up and they were like, yeah, we know. Was it that guy? No, there wasn't. I know it was some video. And they were like, we know that nothing happened, but we have to come here and stuff like that. I forgot what story that was, but I remember there was some story that they actually said that. There was another story I meant to actually tell you guys about as well. But I forgot to. I don't know if you guys heard about it, but the guy, I think he was in Florida. And his girlfriend broke up with him for a guy in Chicago. This man flew all the way to Chicago to meet this man. I forgot what he knocked him out with, but he knocked him out with I think it was a crowbar. Carved his initials in the guy's leg, and then cut off his penis.
Oh, Jesus.
And I think they said the guy had brain damage after that as well.
Well, I guess that explains why the other one's still alive. I would have killed him without.
He carved his initials in him and then cut off his penis.
Did they get him?
Yeah, he's in jail.
Wow, she must have really been worth it. I don't know. What
in the world this girl putting down? she got these men out here doing this kind of stuff for her.
I meant to look up the whole story because I saw brief of it, but I meant to look up the whole story. But I was just like,
yeah, I think I might have seen like that headline come across my Facebook, but I didn't have time to actually look at it because it was like, man, a girlfriend breaks up with dude, and then he travels to the other guy, and there was like, what was the word that they used? I knew what it was referring to. It was referring to what you just said, him cutting off the guy's penis, but it worded it differently. And I was looking at it, and I was just like, what the? You know, I'm gonna come back to read this, look at this article, because this is crazy. Like, I just by reading the headline, I was like, this is crazy. I'm gonna come back and read it, but it slipped my mind, and I never went back and read it. But if that's the article you're talking about, man, that's, I can't deal with that.
If her name is in the news, I hope no other guy is gonna date her.
Yeah, man, I wouldn't date nobody. If
traveling miles for that.
If your stuff is that good, when you got your ex-boyfriend's traveling, because there's no telling what other ex-boyfriends might have done in the past that didn't come to light.
Yeah.
So who knows? But that's.
All right, so we got our guest here. You can take a seat. Madison Jay in the building.
How you doing?
I'm doing good, man.
You missed us playing your My Day to Come track. Oh, actually, that's it. You can't really see. Joy, can you move?
Right here?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. So we got Madison Jay in the building. He is most likely, I think he is like our second, either the third or most times, because I know that J-Rell, the person that we had on the show, been on more times than I think. Would you been on the show 4 times?
I think it's 4.
You fam now.
Hey, Ben family.
Oh, yeah, because I know one time you didn't actually come on to be interviewed.
Yeah.
Yeah, 2 times you came on just to talk about, we were talking about WrestleMania, it was WrestleMania special.
Right.
Yeah, so we didn't actually interview you. And both of them are big wrestling fans, so we might get into some wrestling talk
AKA
too.
Roman Reigns.
Oh, come on.
We need to get right.
Come, we got
you. Straight.
Man, yeah, we're going to get into this.
what's up? We got P Mania in the building.
All right.
Sit there, one of y'all sit there.
Ooh, he is stressed
ooh,
to the
night.
Just gotta get this
umbrella up there.
You know what I mean?
Where y'all coming from?
Hey, man, you know.
Festivity.
You know? Live in effect, man.
Okay. Shoot, I feel like I'd have missed out. Man, come, my man coming in here with this umbrella on.
What's going on?
All right. So, just to go over everything that's been going on, like, because, like, you've been having a big year. Like, I've been seeing you around. Clubs, traveling, and everything.
Right.
Like, how has been the reaction of people, like, across states and stuff like that, like, going to different cities and
it's
everything?
Been, it's been love, and that's what I think the key is, stepping out of your boundaries, out of your territory, and stepping into new territory, new boundaries. Attack those, get your fan base up, get the fan love from other places. It'll always translate back to home. But once you're stepping out, you're bound to pick up new fans. And I think that's the key for artists, is stepping out, you know, picking up those new fans. So that's how you expand your base. And then once the base is expanded, of course, you know, financially things will start to pick up.
And as far, because I know as far as, like, you also was on Tidal and everything like that. Right. Like, have you seen a difference just by traveling, how your fan base has grown as far as that? Can you see the difference with that?
Yeah, definitely. And you mean, like, in terms of, like...
if you listens and stuff like that, oh, like, and follows?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, for the most part, everything has definitely been on the uprise. And mind you, you know what I mean? I would consider myself kind of like a vet in the game. And everything has been on the rise. Like, I've never really had a period of where I was on a decline. Everything has just been up, upward. And I think that's what's key for myself, is just moving forward, always moving forward, always moving up. And, you know, as long as I'm doing that, I don't think I should have, you know, too many problems in the game.
Yeah, because I've seen, like, you've been constantly reinventing yourself. Cause, like, first you started with the raps, like, wrestling.
Right.
And then you went to the EP, returning the... Well, no, first you did the 90s.
Right,
Trapping the 90s. Then you did the album, Return the Gap.
Right.
And now this new track, Line 'Em Up, is like, that's a different kind of flavor right there. What made you go in that direction?
The key is doing something different. Like I said, you know, at first, stepping out of the boundaries in your territory. And that was a record, like, sonically, I haven't really done anything like that for the most part. So it was, you know, when I heard the beat, shout out to Brashiest Monk. He produced that. You know, when I heard it, I was like, this is different. I like the bop of it. I like the vibe of it. I'm gonna write something real slick to it. And basically, that's what we did. We'll Line 'Em Up. Just something that's just very different, but at the same time, it's nothing that's gonna have you, like, with the sour face, like, yo, what is this that Madison's putting out? It's just something that you'll be like, okay, you know, it's not expected, but, you know, we're gonna check it out, and it's, you know, it's gonna be something completely new. And I think that it definitely did do what it needed to do in terms of giving me new energy and new light, especially with the video. Y'all definitely check that out. It's available on YouTube now.
Yeah, I was upset with myself. Like, I was supposed to go to the video premiere, but I swear I thought it, because, like, I know you did it on Saturday, and I was sitting there the whole time, like, I'm going to Madison Jay's video premiere on Sunday. And then I seen somebody on Snap talking about they had Madison Jay premiere. I was like, oh, dad. So I was upset with myself that I didn't get to go there and everything.
Yeah, it was a dope event.
What was your vision as far as the music? Because like it's kind of like that. Trying to think of the what's that TV show? Oh, I'm Living Color. Kind of got that Living Color feel. Was that what you guys were shooting for?
Yeah, shouts out to Head Graphics. You know what I mean? We just both sat down and, you know what I mean, bounced ideas, and we came to that, what you see. And it's definitely very 90s. It's got a 90s influence to it, just something very different, but it was very vibrant. It's very, a lot of colors in the video, that was intentional. It's just something like that, when you see it, it's going to catch your eye, which is one of the things that's important about a visual, is like, it has to catch your eye. So when you check it out, it's just something that's very appeasing to the eye. It's very colorful. And then, like I said, you'll see the homage to, you know, Living Color. You'll see your Living single, you'll see just again that early 90s influence, because that was what we were going for. So it was spot on, and like I said, it's definitely one of those visuals you want to check out. It's available on YouTube now, so y'all definitely check it out.
All right, I got a question for you.
Yes, sir.
So what inspires you? What keeps you inspired? Because I'm hearing a lot of 90s talk,
right?
And thanks for the 90s. So is the 90s one of your biggest inspirations, or just life, one of the many?
Life is the biggest inspiration for me. Of course, you know, I would say most. And the funny thing is like, I can't say most of my living was done in the 90s, because now here we are almost 20 years into the millennium. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So, but it was just a very important part of my life with the 90s. But I would say the biggest inspiration is just life, because so much, you know, in my years of life has transpired. So that's like the biggest inspiration, just like for a painter. You know, most of their surroundings or things that they've gone through, things that they've seen, things that they see in their mind. It's the same thing just with the artistry.
Mm-hmm.
It's just throughout my life, things have occurred, or I've seen things, overheard things, and I'm able to describe those and put it into music form.
Okay. So what in your life has been what about your life has been the biggest impact on your music?
Probably being a father. And it's just because of the mental change, the physical change, just, you know, that you got to endure. It's not just basically, you know, more or less about yourself. You know, you have to include your offspring as well. And then also things that they go through, you basically go through them as well. And also, you know, it's kind of like living vicariously through somebody else. So just with that whole change up. And then also content-wise, because now you have another layer to, you know, basically dip into for content to speak on, to, you know, really get off your chest, per se. So basically it would be like kids, you know what I mean? Fatherhood would be basically like that real big one.
Okay. Now with that, becoming a father, did it make you look at your music and change everything, or just certain things?
Not even at first, you know, it wasn't really a change, but now, just because they're getting older, you know, I mean, their intellect is very high, their comprehension is very high. So right now is the period of where I'm, you know, I kind of have to start being selective and careful.
Mm-hmm.
Basically finding the balance of artistry, and also like, hey, my kids, you know, nieces, nephews, other children. Because, you know, that's a reflection, you know. So at the end of the day, I don't want to leave a bad reflection mm-hmm. to the youth. You know, at the end of the day, I'm a human being. But, you know, try to at least give the most positive jewels to the kids. At least to let them know, like, hey, you know, you can walk, you know, a positive arrow, mm-hmm. a positive life. You know what I mean? At the end of the day. So right now, like I said, you know, trying to make sure, hey, certain words I might not use, or certain things that I might not put in the visuals and things like that, because like I said, you got kids at the end of the day, so you know, you don't want them to pick up on the bad things.
Yeah. So, if you don't mind me asking, how old are you?
My kids? Daughter, she's 11, and my son is 9. Fresh 9 too, yeah, actually.
So do they critique you on your music?
It's funny, yeah, they actually do. My daughter especially, she'll definitely let me know, like, hey, if this is the one, and if it's not the one. And usually it's funny because my kids are getting more in tune with my music. So like the same way they'll casually pick up on somebody on the radio or on, you know, whatever they listen to music through, they do the same thing with my music as well. They basically integrate me in that sea of artists that, just the same way, you know, in the mainstream is, they've got daddy in there as well. So that's like a kind of a cool thing, because that means like, hey, I'm one of them now, you know?
Yeah.
You know, I'm cool. I'm one of the cool artists now that they listening to. So that's just very dope as well.
Okay. Are they asking you when you're going to, like, as far as, like, working with certain artists, are they saying, you know, daddy, when are you going to work with this person? Or when are you going to do stuff with
that? Funny thing is, not necessarily, but more or less just have you met question. Have you met him? Have you met them? And have you met them? I think as they just get older, then it'll be like, well, when are you going to work with them? Or when are you going to work with them? But right now, they're just at the have you met stage.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So are they, as far as music-wise, Do you see that them wanting to get into the music business as well? I mean,
they could slide in there just because of the influence from dad. And that's just something, like I said, making sure to leave. If that's something that they do dive into in the future, I want to make sure that I left us a great foundation for them to do such at the end of the day on both sides of artistry and business-wise as well. Because I want to make sure, again, if they do dive into this field, I want to make sure they just have the best opportunity possible. The same way if they were doing athletics or anything, education, if they're a doctor, I want them to go to the best, you know, doctorate school or whatever. You know, just it's the same thing. So if they ever do decide, I think they'll be good because they got, you know, a great teacher. You know, they got a great sensei and myself. So I would like to see that, though, if my kids do decide to get into music, because I think they'll be dope.
Okay. So how was performing at the fair?
It was wonderful, man. It was dope. You know, shouts out to DJ King Clash. Shouts out to P-Mania. Shouts out to Zip. Shouts out to Black Bouquet. They were the supporting cast. Madison Jay and Friends, something rare at the fair. Just real dope, man. We were at the fair. And like I said, we used to catch the cat bus to the fair. You know, real talk. We used to catch the bus to the fair. You know, cause a little bit of mayhem in the fair as youngsters. But now, just as men, to be able to perform on the stage, like we're talking about at the fair, candy apples, you know what I'm saying, the funnel cakes with the extra sugar, the chocolate, you know, the fried product, all that, you know, deep fried Oreos, all that good stuff. And then we're talking about being able to touch the stage. I mean, what else are we talking about here? What else can you ask for in an opportunity like that? So just to be blessed to be able to do that. And then the funny thing is when we're talking about we're talking about kids. My son was there for this whole experience of being able to watch, like, literally, he's on the stage, you know what I'm saying, watching front row, backstage action, all of that, you know what I mean. So tying all of that full circle, it's just important that leaving a foundation, like I said, for him if he decides to come in the game, he knows how to move because he just, you know, he saw his dad, you know what I mean. Bless the stage and just move accordingly, just in general. But that whole opportunity just to be able to rock out at the fair and then just to have my team there. I mean, I you know, you don't ask for opportunities like that too often. So just to do it is just, like I said, a blessing, man. And ready to do it again when the time calls again.
I mean, yeah, I imagine that just had to be an amazing feeling. Mm-hmm. To, you know, like you just said, to grow up and just being there. And then actually being on the other side of it now, being on that stage and performing for everybody. I mean, how was it for you?
Epic, man. So epic. The diversity of the crowd, the people, the love, the energy was epic.
So have you guys been rapping for about the same amount of time? Y'all got into it together?
I mean, it's funny because, like, at the end of the day, the timeline is just... timeline is really what it is, but it's just kind of, you know, at the end of the day, fate brought me and the homie together, you know, at the end of the day, just really off of the work, but then just the camaraderie of friendship just evolved, and just at the end of the day, this is my brother, you know, just the same way, you know, my brother MG Ken is in the building, same way, you know, that's my brother, you know, this is my brother right here, and just at the end of the day, you know, he's got his joint out, it's getting ready to come, Andalay. The single in the video that's getting ready to drop. And like I said, it's one thing about me is just putting, you know what I mean, my people in the positions of making sure they're in the best positions to win. At the end of the day, that's what this is all about. You know, it's just making sure the, you know, the kids, making sure your family, your friends, making sure they're just in the best positions of life, just in general. Whatever they want to do in life, they're in that position as best as they can be. So at the end of the day, you know, this guy right here, shouts out.
Oh, yeah.
Shouts out to Maine. You already know what it is. But right now, man, HCS really is on a hot streak. You know, really, I think we kind of like the new age NWO. Nash Hall and Hope.
Wow. All right. You know what I mean? Okay. That's a big comparison, yeah. Right?
Disruptive, you know what I mean? Causing disorder in the game, man, because at the end of the day, you know, just coming, you know, the one of the biggest good guys, you know what I mean, pulling the flip. Nah, man, we, you know, at the end of the day, HES isn't having it. You know what I mean? We're not taking anything laying down. Like I said, we really got a tight grip on the city right now. I kind of like three of the hottest, you know, hottest joints in the city. And I, you know, I put that on everything right now. But, you know, that's what it is, man.
So what's next for y'all?
Right now everybody's working, just pushing the, you know, pushing the singles. You know, I got Line 'Em Up. Got My Day to Come. Still buzzing, still fire. We got The Roll On. Got P-Mania coming. With Andelay. So it's just basically about work right now. Just continuously working. Because if you're not working, I don't know how you're eating. You know what I mean? So at the end of the day, that's what's important for us, is continuously working. Because, you know, continuously working, something's going to shake. Something's bound to pop off and something's bound to happen. So as long as we staying active, like I said, everything should, you know, fall in place.
Okay. So for P-Mania, Andelay, what's that about?
Oh, yeah, that's my single coming out, Andelay, video dropping. It's about good times, about diversity, about the people. As I was making the song, it was like, okay, the beat, Andelay. And I rolled with it. And it's like that, as I perform it, the people, they want to hear it. The Spanish culture love it. I play it, the babies dance to it. What caught me, I was at a store, I was playing Andelay. It wasn't my song that I thought that I was going to run with, be a single. So, and it was some Mexican family beside me. Mm-hmm. I was playing Andelay, the little baby, dancing, going crazy. It's about three, Andelay. As the dad holding him in the driver's seat, I'm like, you like that song? Like, oh, yes, we love it. It went from there, spread like wildfire. As I'm talking to my Spanish friends, everybody did, oh man, we love it. And everybody, as I perform it, we love it. So it just went from there. As I was writing it, the thought, the creative process was crazy. Mm-hmm. I just being in another zone.
So can you speak a lot of Spanish?
I'm learning, definitely learning. I'm definitely learning. Got Spanish friends teaching me, like, hey man, get you. Oh yeah. Okay,
what you got learning. So far?
What?
Spanish.
See, look at it. You gotta
put you on the spot.
It's just a little bit right now. You know, it's just the little ins and outs, basics right now. Mm-hmm. But definitely learning, though. Like, definitely learning.
That's good.
Teach English, teach me Spanish. Uh-huh. You know, right now, in the process. So.
There you go.
But they love me. The culture love me. And mm-hmm. I love them. Everybody, I'm telling you.
Well, it's definitely not too hard of a language to learn, so I'm confident you'll catch on to it.
So you, yeah, you say that, but it's a lot of rolls. I didn't know you got to roll a lot on the tongue.
I still can't do that roll.
That's not hard.
Yes, it is.
But yeah, it's just a song. It's great energy, man, and the people love it as I perform it. I'm going to give it to him. Yeah, straight raw, uncut.
Now,
the video going to be epic.
So, yeah, so what do you envision for the video?
Oh, man, my vision as the Spanish culture, kind of hip-hop-ish type thing, she knows it. As you follow me on IG, I have a clip out, and you can see it. It's epic.
Well, let the people know where they can see this clip.
Oh, yeah, the clip is on IG. Follow me at #1 P-Mania. On IG, and you will see the clip. It's going to be epic. The video dropping soon. It's going to be epic. Promise you.
Definitely.
Are we going to see that hat in there?
You will see more hats.
All
right. Awesome. In the plan. I'm not even going to say a lot, but just follow me on IG 1P Mania. And I promise you will see it. Epic.
Nice.
Epic. I got to know. So how'd you come up with the name P Mania?
P Mania. Okay. From old name. PT. Everybody know me as PT. You know, street name PT. Pastor Troy. So P Mania. I was at Madison actually. Like, we was like, I met him this years ago. He was like, yeah, just come up, you know, find yourself, come up with a name that fits you, suitable for yourself, make sure you good with it. So I'm like, okay. I sat around, a couple of came around. Maniac. P Mania, boom, Madison. How you go, P Mania? Why? because it's me, P-Mania, is very diverse. His energy is different. That's what makes P-Mania. He's very diverse and a ball of energy. I promise you. Just follow. I'm in my own lane. He's different. He's very different. Mm-hmm. So P-Mania, that's how that came about. Like, just a ball of energy. I'm in my own lane. So, like a little maniac running through the industry.
Right. Like,
oh, I can see P-Mania. You. I can see yeah. You definitely got a lot of energy.
Right. Oh yeah. So a lot of people, they see me like they've been screaming Mania. Yes, like it. Instead of 1-8-M-8-9, it's like 3 behind there. Mania. Right.
So you got to stretch out that.
It's not Mania. Like, yeah, you're definitely going to stretch it out. But he's a baller full of energy, Mania. That's how I came up with that name. Chilling. You know, my own children. Writing music. I came up with it. Stuck with it. And love it.
Okay. That's me. Yeah. So, with you guys being rappers, do you incorporate a lot of R&B and singing into your music?
Yeah, you definitely get those elements. You know, with P, I know he's definitely, you know, he dives into the vocals. You know, I've had records where, you know, I've had the, you know, what probably a feature more or less. Even just myself, of just, you know, harmonizing and stuff like that. In the future, you're just going to get even more. You know, you're getting even more music, because at the end of the day, you know, rappers are bigger than rap, you know, because it's music. At the end of the day, it's just, hey, the box of how you can see it will be classified as rap and a mixture of something. But at the end of the day, it's just music, whether it be jazz, whether it be punk rock influence, you know, whatever those elements are at the time, they'll be, you know, they'll be used. But right now, especially with a record like Line 'Em Up, it's just got those elements of a little bit of electro in there, a little bit of a dash of go-go, you know what I mean? Just got a little bit of hip-hop in there. It's just a little eclectic clash of sounds. So at the end of the day, that's just really, you know, myself. And then, you know, just a squad, just doing different things, you know, because at the end of the day, we can't really be put in a box. Yeah. Bigger than the box. We're out of the box. You know, we look at the box, you know, from the outside in. So, you know, you're definitely gonna get a little clash of everything musically, you know.
Okay.
When it comes down to it.
So what do you guys think about the state of rap now?
Hold on that right quick, because that's what I was going to actually say for the second half and everything. Let me play some music right quick, and then we're going to come back and mainly ask about some of the albums that have come out. Because, like out of the albums that have came out, me personally, like, I actually posted this earlier. Like, I feel like out of the hip-hop albums that have just came out, T.I. has the most replay value, I feel. Out of that, but I'm gonna see what y'all thoughts are as far as the albums that have come out, and then like I said, we'll talk a little bit more about the wrestling and everything like that. Dip in a little more of your personality and everything else that's going on. But first track that I'm about to play, I'm gonna play Sean Archer's Passport. This is Sean Archer's Passport. Then we'll come back. I'm chopping up some more with P-Mania and Madison Jay. All right.
My love gon' take your body, there is like a GPS. I'm going north, south, east, west. My love gon' take your body, there is like a GPS. GPS, I'ma take your body, I'ma take your body. My love gon' take your body, there is like a GPS. GPS, I'ma take your body, I'ma take your body. My love gon' take your body, there is like a GPS. GPS, up, left, right, my love gonna take your body to so many heights. You gonna reach your climax on cloud 9, it's a permanent flight. When I touch your body and soul's gonna feel like vacation for the rest of your life. For the rest of your life, gonna feel like you're on the island. like sex in the sand in Bali. Oh, we could go with a Maui, move them hips like them girls in Hawaii. You know, girl, I love your style. When I look at you, you drive me wild. Lay you down, hey, flowing just like the Nile. So wet, we might need a towel. Oh, we could go with a friend and kiss by the Eiffel Tower. Let's go to Bora Bora and make love when the sun go down, down, down. It don't matter, cause when I'm with you, it feel like I'm home. So let my love change the time zone. I'm going north, south, east, west. My love gon' take your body there, is like a GPS. I'm going north, south, east, west. My love gon' take your body there, is like a GPS. GPS, I'ma take your body, I'ma take your body. My love gon' take your body there, is like a GPS. GPS, I'ma take your body, I'ma take your body. My love gon' take your body there, is like a GPS. GPS, let's go to the motherland and hold hands in Cape Town. Hotels in Fiji, see the fishes while we lay down. Let's go to China or maybe Japan. Let's go to Italy, we can turn it to a playground. We gon' ride, 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 ride. As long as my baby, you're my side, 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 side. Anything for you, I'ma give you all my love. When I'm with you, it's like a drug. You was blessed from up above. Forever, all we got is trust. Forever, all we got is us. So let's go to Punta Cana or eat breakfast in bed while we chillin' in the Bahamas. It don't matter, cause when I'm with you, it feel like I'm home. So let my love change the time zone. I'm going north, south, east, west. My love gon' take your body there, is like a GPS. I'm going north, south, east, west. My love gon' take your body there, is like a GPS. GPS, I'ma take your body, I'ma take your body. My love gon' take your body there, is like a GPS. GPS, I'ma take your body, I'ma take your body. My love gon' take your body there, is like a GPS. GPS.
Know that I'm poppin', that's probably what she taught me, yeah. Proper, had to lay it down proper, that's why she call me Poppy, yeah. Stop it, stop it, stop it. The f*** got options, yeah, yeah. But you got options, yeah.
Her or her, I can't decide. Hurricanes or water slides. Whoa. If you come and bring your friends, uh-huh. I'm thinking maybe four or five. Hello. Got a couple valley from LA. Uh-huh. Got foreign from Dubai. Got all them round the way. And I got more than more than five. Damn. Now she choking off the smoke. Either that or she choking off the deep. So many you thought I had a cheat code. Yo, it was easy, they ain't nothing but a freak though. I'm sleep though. But they ain't peep though. The monster about to have a feast though. Yum, 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 mmm, delicio. Go to infinito. Jump, jump, poppin'. And if that's a problem, you can kick rocks and play in traffic.
Go ahead.
To make it happen. You know I got options, please just stop it. I know you photoshopping, I know you IG thotting, I know you plotting. You know a n- came from the bottom, you know a n- got it. And now you know a young, young
poppin'. She know that I'm poppin'. That's probably what she taught me, yeah. Proper, had to lay it down proper. That's why she call me Poppy, yeah. Stop it, stop it, stop it. The bitch got options, yeah, yeah. You got options, yeah.
Girl, I got options. Models is popping, cougars that solid. I got a chick from DC, she got a new, but that ain't my problem. Yeah, got 31 flavors, I'm really a player. Tooted and booted and don't hit him later. Ain't tell your mans cause you know he a hater. I put it on you and you call me Poppy. So baby girl, forget about the mother guys. And you ain't never had a one night stand, but that's the one that probably changed your life. Ooh, if anything could happen when you pull up with me, understand that you're fuck with a G. I'm the man that your man wanna be. You know I got it
poppin'. She know that I'm poppin'. That's probably what she taught me, yeah. Proper, had to lay it down proper. That's why she call me Poppy, yeah. Stop it, stop it, stop it. The bitch I got options, yeah. Yeah, you know I got options, yeah.
told me that I'm super fly. Baby, you ain't never lied. He's going down right here. Yeah, he's going down right here. Feeling you, feeling me. Now you feel my energy. He's going down right here. Yeah, he's going down right here. Yeah, yeah, she that one right there. Yeah, yeah, there she go there. Miss that Henny with that coke right there. Girl, you might know what's up, yeah, yeah. I got you in the kitchen right there. Girl, you know you get down right there. And girl, you compliment the juice to the max, though. Got me feeling like a man of the year. Girl, I'm tryna get to know you. Pour a couple more, we a little too sober. She might be a schoolgirl, but that body got me thinking entertainer. She done had enough ordinary love. Yeah, I can see it in your eyes that I'm the one to change your life. Told me that I'm super fly. Baby, you ain't never lied. He's going down right here. Yeah, he's going down right here. Feeling you, feeling me. Know you feel my energy. He's going down right here. Yeah, he's going down right here. We can take it slow, make it comfortable. We can start a fire, singing like a choir. Yeah. I can take you high, yeah, for a second time. Whoa.
So sexy, mama. nothing like a sexy woman. A woman with a sexy attitude. A sexy woman. Sexy talk. Let's go.
There's nothing like a sexy woman.
We're back. Before I went, I was talking about the albums that were currently released and everything. We've been doing a couple album reviews on the website. You can go and check them out. Joy actually did a review on Quavo's album. I did a review on Mario's, which I really didn't hear too much advertisement on that. I feel like Mario is one that slept on artists, and then he was actually on Empire last night too. But I love that album. It actually I feel like it was one of them albums that went back to the essence of R&B. And I remember when we were talking to Suzanne, she was actually talking about R&B songs now that can last the time, but basically you can cover and everything. There's not too many
getting back that, to actual singing.
Yeah.
Singing aspect and being able to
cover. And I actually listened to Ella May's album today, and like that was one of those albums I felt like went back to the essence as well. Like she has this one track on there, like I feel like could be a wedding song. Right now the name of the song kinda slipped my mind. But I had posted it up on Facebook and everything. But as far as the hip-hop albums and everything, the ones that most people are talking about is Drake, Pusha T. I guess you can include Jay-Z's in there, T.I., and Lil Wayne. And I can't think of any other. Oh, yeah, Travis Scott.
Nipsey.
J-Rock. Oh, yeah, J-Rock. Yeah, that was a nice album. That was also a slept-on album. Yeah. But out of all the ones that I've listened to, like T.I. is the only one that I feel like I could listen to. Even though like I'm a big Pusha T fan, T.I., that album, like, and it was a lot of tracks. Because like I've been talking about how people have been putting too many tracks on their albums and everything. And that one, even though it was a lot of tracks, like all the tracks, I felt like you could listen to it and not pay attention to it. There's a lot of tracks because like all of them have a meaning to it and everything. And like I felt like it had that replay value. Have you listened to the album yet?
I'm gonna be real. I haven't listened to a lot of albums this year. I'm really picking up on that sense of like, all right, at the end of the day, I'm an artist myself, so I don't really want to get contaminated with the wave of another artist. You know what I mean? Trying to be too much of a big influence on me while I'm making music. So the albums that I have heard, you know, they've been quality, you know, pretty quality for the most part. It's weird to me when people say that like music is in like certain states and crises and stuff like that, and I used to be a follower and believer of that, but then I just, you know, as I got older and kind of wiser, it's like every era is going to have its energy. Kind of coincide back with the R&B record, right? What R&B? Now, granted, the people in this room, we grew up on a certain era of music. Mm-hmm. The same way our parents grew up on a certain era of music. And I can vouch for you 100%. For the most part, most parents of that era will like look down on the era that even we, you know. But now, in retrospect, as it's aged, that era is now looked at like, oh yeah, you know, that was a dope era. It had a lot of classic, you know what I mean, bops and vibes to it. Mm-hmm. Very influential era. The same way it's going to come to another, you know, decade and space to where you know, what's going on right now is going to be looked at like, yo man, you know, we missed out, like this, that, and the third, because every era is going to carry a different energy. And at the time, you're not really going to be able to understand it because you're living in the moment. You're in the storm. So yeah. You don't really know the damage that's going on until the aftermath of like, man, you know what? Because it's, you know, now we're in the era where we're looking at people like your Ludacris, your Nellys, your Ja Rules. We're looking at them as like
ancient artists now.
Yeah.
And I remember a time where those were the guys who were the soundtracks to, like, my, you know what I mean, teenage years. So I'm like, I'm looking at, like, how are they? They're old. So I'm looking at, like, okay, that's where you recognize that time is going to pass. And each, like I say, each era is just going to have its, you know, its essence. And its, you know, level of where this is the culture. This is just what it is, for better or for worse. So I look at it as just like, yo, at the end of the day, everything is going to have some point of growth. So I, like I said, I look at the body of works that came out, like with Kanye and what I like to call the seven song theory, what they were doing with the whole seven songs. Like, when, I feel like when you look back at it, that's going to be looked at as legendary. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? Because of just the fact of Kanye spearheaded all these projects out at such a short amount of time. No real big promotion. Just, I mean, I don't want to call it hoopla. At the end of the day, it boils down promotion. But they had kind of different promotional strategies and stuff with actually getting those bodies of works out to the point of 5 years from now, people probably will be on that wave of putting out works. And then they'll be like, yo, remember when Kanye put that out in that, you know, that whole way. So it's certain things that, like I say, you in the storm, so you're not going to be able to see it. Mm-hmm. But then in retrospect, you'll be like, yo, that was dope. That was crazy. Because some of these guys that's quote-unquote mumble rap, we're going to look at mumble rap as that was an era of music. You know what I mean? And it might be, you know, it might be missed. You know, but at the end of it, I don't want to knock, you know, it's like I can't knock the people in the 30s and 40s and 50s what they did with music, you know, because they just worked what they had.
Yeah.
Same way these guys now, they're working with what they have and just the best of their abilities, for better or for worse, or what that, you know, you can take that for them. But that's, you know, overall, it's a handful of solid albums, so that always speaks volumes when it's good product out. You know what I mean? When it's good, people can be like, hey, it's this album's, this is the album of the year, this is the album of the year. But if you could just say one or two, that's when we got a problem. Because it's like, that's it? Of all the people who are putting out music, you mean only tell me only two or three or just, you know, that's it? Nah, you got an actual handful of projects, and we aren't even done with the year. We still mm-hmm. got 2.5 months, so mm-hmm. somebody could come through with a banger, a sleeper, like, you know, because it's fourth quarter, you know, a lot of the big dogs, they like to drop fourth quarter, so it could be an exciting fourth quarter. Somebody come with a sleeper. 2018 has already been like a, you know, crazy year on the music end. So I just think, like, going into 2019 now, we're yeah. going to see even more doper product coming out, because it's a lot of people who have come out of the forefront. They really got their wave established. They getting their hype to move on now to the next level or their next project or, you know, whatever their next wave is going to be.
The problem is, it's even with there being, you know, a handful of good albums out,
right.
It's they're so far and in between and mixed in with a lot of the mumble rap that's out there that, right.
And
you know,
what we're calling mainstream now, the mumble rap.
Exactly. Well, you know, for us, like you said, I mean, we grew up on a certain style of music, right. You know. And, you know, a lot of what's out there today, you know, which I'm not going to sit here and say all of it's bad.
Right.
Because not all of it is bad. Most of it, you know, you when we listen to it and when we want to listen to it, it's when we're in a certain type of mood.
Right.
We're in a certain place.
So you just, you know, like you're at, in my
like
head.
Like you were saying a couple weeks ago.
I'm about
you know?
To say that.
Yeah, we're like at a club or right. at a bar or at some type of party,
right.
you know, and that music, you know, you're in that space and you want to hear that type of music. But when you're listening to music, a lot of, you know, our age, we tend to go back to the 90s and, mm-hmm. you know, even the early 2000s.
Right.
You know, because a lot of stuff out now, you know, we look at it, we're just like, you know, in the world, you know, this other stuff ain't making no sense.
Because I go to a club and one song plays, another one comes on, it sounds just like the previous one.
That's true. That's true. Yep. But again, I gotta, you know, in defense of that, we had the same thing coming up because... I clearly remember I'm a big Wu-Tang head, right? So in the 90s, their whole thing was like, yo, we're anti, you know, we're anti glossy, shiny, which is what, you know, of course, the Bad Boy era, what they kind of ushered in. And I remember that Bad Boy era, some, you know, really, especially post Biggie, the people were like going in on Puff, like, yo, you're destroying the game. Mm-hmm. Yo, you're what are you doing? Get this Puff out of here. Like, he's, but again, in retrospect now, we like, yo, those are, what are you talking about? More money, more problems. You know, No Way Out, the album, like, yo, it's Puff. What do you mean? Anything Puff put, like, you know, it's looked at now as like, yo, that's gold. You know what I mean? Again, going back to Little John and, you know, in the 2000s, the Crooked. What is Little John doing? He's destroying the game. They ain't even rapping. They just chanting.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Here we are. Yo, that's crunk music. What do you mean? That turned the club up. What are you talking?
Yeah.
Now it's looked at as like, yo. So I feel like the same thing is going to happen now. But this, you know, throughout every dark cloud, you got that sunshine. You know what I mean? Mind you, MC Hammer, 1990, you know what I mean? He had, like, the highest selling album. But at the same time, you had Ice Cube dropping America's Most Wanted, one of the most potent albums ever in rap history that dropped that same year. So, again, throughout all the BS that comes out, there's always going to be those rays of sunshine, people who are just giving you the raw product, because at the end of the day, can't stop good music, great music from being created just because it's, you know, nonsense, BS out there, because that's just not enough. That's just going to stop creatives from creating.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of people give 6ix9ine a lot of slack and everything, but, like, honestly feel like there's some tracks that I don't like, and there's some, but, like, he actually, like, because I actually talked to my boy about this, MD, like, he don't like him, and I'm like, don't you hear a little bit of
like Onyx?
Yeah, Onyx. Like, when I, cause like I after I listened to it over and over and over, and the crazy thing about it, I remember like somebody asked him, were you influenced by Onyx, and he didn't know who they were.
Funny, right?
Yeah, I was like I honestly felt like he had got his style from them and everything, but like he sounds like I could see them on a track together.
Just,
he would fit perfectly in.
Perfect. And you know, like, granted, at the end of the day, like, you gotta call a spade a spade. Like, we're not, you know, one thing people gotta realize, like, 6ix9ine is not out here trying to give you, like, a 5-mic classic album.
Mm-hmm.
He's not trying to give you, you know, one of the most, you know, sharpest verses ever, you know, the rewind verse. He's just basically riding the beat, putting energy behind it. That's basically about it. And you know, for the most part, some of the energy he puts out, I can rock with it on a music level. You know what I mean? It's because I understand what he's doing. And it's funny because literally, it's just like an Onyx. It's just, he represents energy, and I'm here for that high octane energy of like what, you know, Southerners would consider crunk. Like, yo, I'm trying to get crunk. You know what I mean? I'm trying to get, you know, riot music. You know what I mean? I'm trying to, you know, get it active, you know what I mean, in the spot. Mm-hmm. So at the end of the day,
kind of like what MOP used to do.
Basically, what MOP is, just, hey, MOP, Brownsville, they have the Brownsville element to it. And then, mind you, they come up under in the 80s and 90s environment. Then, at the end of the day, mind you, 6ix9ine's from Brooklyn. And it's crazy because no matter, you can't escape. Some things you just can't escape. Like, sometimes you're going to be just like your parents, even though it's like you're not around your parents all the time or whatever. It's just, sometimes you're just going to get the traits of your parents just because, hey, that's, you know, the DNA, it's in you. So the same thing with people in influence. Yeah, you might not even know, you might not even know you're getting influenced by an influence, but it's just the fact of you're in the culture or you're within the means of what's going on with that energy, and you just happen to scoop it up. You know what I mean? So I just see with 6ix9ine, he's just getting he's carrying the Brooklyn tradition on. You know, at the end of the day, anybody knows about Brooklyn, now we know how they give it up. So it's just one of those things that just, like, he's just carrying it on. But on the flip side, you got a guy like Joey Badass, who's also, you know what I mean, from Brooklyn. And he's a guy who's giving you that lyrical dexterity. You know, he's giving you basically the quote-unquote will be the essence of hip-hop. But it's always got to be a balance, though, at the end of the day.
Yeah.
You got to have a balance. And, like, 6ix9ine, you got to have a 6ix9ine because that shows you, hey, there can be people on the other side at a high level. You know what I mean? Not trying to knock 6ix9ine anything about it, but it's, hey, on that other side of the coin, you got people really out here spitting and composing, you know what I mean, songs and stuff like that. So,
Cause you was talking about the culture and everything, We got to bring it back to North Carolina and everything.
Right.
We all know about the Dreamville Festival that was coming out, and like it was pushed back to April. And I should know this because like I'm selling the tickets and everything.
Right.
But a lot of people were complaining that there were no North Carolina artists on there. And I'm starting to feel like a lot of people feel like stuff should be given to them. Instead of them, like, there were North Carolina artists on there, on the ballot, because you had Rhapsody and King Mez.
It was three.
Three? Who else?
It was Luke, who's from Charlotte.
Oh.
You know what I mean? You got Rap, Snow Hill Riley, and you got Mez from Raleigh.
So like, it's not like he didn't have anybody on there, but, like, I feel like, because a lot of people were trying to leech on to, like, the radio side. I'm not sure what happened, what transpired, but I just saw a lot of people saying that the radio stations lied to them, say that they were going to get them on and stuff like that. Like, it just feels like a lot of people just feel like things should be given to them. Because, like looking at you, like, I see you traveling.
Right.
Like, you're not trying to have somebody hand you everything. Like, you traveling and doing all that. Like, what do you have, like, advice to these people and everything about just
stop looking for a handout. Like, stop looking for a handout. This is not, you know, this isn't parenthood. This isn't a game of, you know, being baby. You got to go out and make your own way. You know what I mean? This is like, hey, you're grown now. You got to go make your own way. And it speaks volumes to people, to other people. When someone, as opposed to not saying never ask for help, but just trying to make a means for themselves. And then last resort, hey, extending the hand. Because at the end of the day, when people see that you're trying to make your own way, they're like, I don't have no problem trying to help you out because I see what you're trying to do. And I know, you know, that's just my mantra. At the end of the day, I'm not waiting for a label to come down and a big miracle to come in. No, I'm out here just, you know, making my own way. I am my label. I am my boss. You know, I'm the clock, you know, at the end of the day. And I have to continuously work. I can't just, like I said, just wait on something to come. And I think for artists, it's key that you just continuously work on your craft and not wait for anything to come to you. In regards to that Dreamville thing, that's nonsense at the end of the day, because you got a guy who's like bringing, like, I don't think people understand the fiscal means of what was about to be with that festival. Like, there was about to be so much revenue that was about to be generated. Mind you, you know, the hurricane, of course, came through and messed everything up, but that was about to be a huge boost, not just for like Raleigh, but for like the state. You know what I mean? The state was about to, you know, get a mean payday off of that. But at the end of the day, you got this guy showing, of course, Luke, hey, this dude's on my label and he's from Charlotte. Of course I'm going to show love to him. Mm-hmm. Hey, Rhapsody, she's on Rock Nation, basically like my label mate. Of course I'm going to show love to her. King Mez, you know what I mean? This dude like was on Compton, you know what I mean? Grammy nominated album. He's, you know, working with Dr. Dre. Why would I not show love to him and throw him up there? So basically, you got your bases covered with hometown. And then at the end of the day, that, you know, like I said, you're bringing in all these people from all across the world, artists. This is your time to like really mingle and rub elbows with people from all walks of life. That's your opportunity right there. You know what I mean? A performance would definitely be like dope. That would be like kind of like a cherry on top. But at the end of the day, again, it goes to being self-sufficient. You got to go out there and work and utilize those opportunities. That's an opportunity that Cole is presenting to everybody. And, you know, hey, y'all, just you. Do what you do. If you want to, you can perform in, you know what I mean, in a crowd. You're here. You know what I mean? In the festival, work, mingle. You know what I mean? Utilize the opportunities. And just at the end of the day, that's just... You know, that's just kind of what it boils down to for artists. Utilize your opportunities and do for self at all times.
Because, like, it's actually bringing attention to North Carolina. Because, like, you see all these other cities. Like, Philadelphia has a festival. Atlanta has a festival. Then they have a festival in California. And he said that he wanted to bring something back to his city, his state and everything. So, like you said, like, even though you're not performing, this is still an opportunity to actually meet, network with people. Because, like, even, like, with the thing in Houston that you always go to and everything. Right. Like, it's the same thing. Like, I'm sure that he probably will have something where you can start networking and everything. Right. So, this is just the beginning. Like, this is a seed that's being planted in North Carolina. But a lot of people just, like, that's all I saw online is people complaining when the lineup was done. Like, it just didn't make no sense to me. Like, how you complaining this man's bringing something to our state? He didn't have to do that.
You know, it happens. Unfortunately, it happens.
They're going to always find something to complain about.
Always.
People are never happy.
Can't make everyone happy. Mm-hmm.
Just got to keep doing you at the end of the day.
Coach Ray said the Beatles grinded for 8 years in the strip clubs before they got on.
Hey, shouts out to Coach Ray, man. You know what I mean? Much love to Coach Ray. Hey, and big shouts out to Petty, man. Big shout out to the OG Petty. And shouts out to Coach Ray. I definitely see y'all, man. And really, you know, sidebar, big shouts out to those two dudes just for influencing young men.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? At Athens High School to be, you know, positive and productive men. Shouts out to Theta Phi Psi. You already know. T Phi!
You know.
You already know.
So,
you know what I mean?
So, yeah, shout out to them and everything. I was supposed to get up with Petty about getting up, trying to do something with Theta and everything. I'm going to get up with you, Petty. Yeah, I just been busy.
Yeah, man. Definitely, you know, no excuse, but we definitely going, you know, we're going to make it happen, man. Everything in due time, definitely.
But switching up the subject and everything, like I said, we have a bunch of big wrestling fans, and we got a couple pay-per-views coming up and everything. Wanted to dig in your head and everything. The first one up, we have the first women pay-per-view. I think it's kind of ironic because they're going back to Saudi Arabia and they can't have any females in that. So I was wondering, do y'all feel like that's the reason why?
Of course.
Obviously.
That's the main reason. I mean, they did the greatest Royal Rumble. The females felt some type of way about that.
They're like, right before Crown Jewel, let's put this all females.
Right before. We know you guys aren't allowed here. we're just going to give you this pay-per-view.
We're going to make sure y'all get paid for something.
I know, right?
Yeah.
We can't pay y'all for just sitting here and doing nothing.
But I'm gonna be real. That's a crazy situation in terms of women can't compete. That's just I've heard some crazy things about what men have tried to do in terms of stopping women. But that right there is just crazy. But WWE, what are we doing right now? You know what I mean? What are we doing right now? Because this now, outside of just, all of this right here, now you're taking another level. This is almost treason. Is this treason? Is Vince McMahon and Co., are they up for treason?
That is so dramatic.
We beefing right now with what's on here, are we not? This is a beef going.
So they had that plan before that happened. I mean, I know why they're not counseling it, but before that.
Because the thing was, so when you went and did Greatest Royal Rumble, you guys, it seemed like propaganda with the whole, look at this country, and they're so great, they're so this, but yet you can't have women perform?
That money is great.
That's what it is.
Money is great, man. $500 million?
Man, buku money.
And then you come back. Now you're coming back, and then we got this whole political thing going with the reporter. Was the reporter that you know? We know we pretty much obviously know he's dead. He didn't leave out the place,
right?
You know, and it's causing major problems for them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, everybody in the news, sports. I mean, everybody's been calling them out. What are y'all doing? They're still going,
right?
You know, they're just like, oh well, we're gonna. Watch.
We're gonna monitor
the situation.
Right.
No,
right.
You're going to say we're gonna still go because that's millions and millions of dollars that we're making.
But with the contract, if they break that, wouldn't they get sued by Saudi?
It depends. I'm pretty sure they got clauses in the contract that if at some point if it's gonna make the company lose money or look really bad, then I'm pretty sure they can break that contract.
I was about to say if they ain't canceled now, then I'm like, hey,
they're still pushing those promos and everything.
I don't know. I don't think.
But they might. The other thing they're saying though is they might move it. To I think England.
The last thing I heard is it's going to still be in Saudi, just a smaller venue, but still in Saudi. Because I don't think they're selling out the tickets in the big venue. So I heard they were moving it to a smaller one.
Okay.
That's and still smart. In Saudi.
I mean, business-wise, that's smart. I mean, you know.
The backlash they're about to receive,
still,
though.
The reports are still saying, hey, look, y'all need to cancel this.
Yeah.
That American dude.
If they take a dip right. in the stock market.
Oh, yeah. That, really that, huge oh, yeah. dip oh, yeah. in the that's stock market. They're going to yeah.
they gonna be like, cancel.
Yeah. Yeah. Last time I saw that, because like, my dad owned stocks, and I know they were in the 90s. And I know, like, I don't know if I should be saying exactly when my dad bought the stocks, but, like, yeah, it's a big profit from when he bought the stocks to where they're at now. I'm not sure exactly if they dipped or anything, but, like, the stock has rose, like, the past couple of months and everything. So
I heard it's gone. It dropped a couple of points within the last couple of weeks because of all of this stuff. It's dropped a few points, but not anything that's going to worry them. To the point where they're gonna be like, okay, we need to stop.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, I think it only dropped like 2 or 3 points. Like, that's nothing to them. That's probably a couple. That's probably like a few million.
Well,
in the tank.
At least the positive is the people who want to see the women. At least they get one pay per view a year. At least that's the positive. Because they have to do Saudi. I think like.
For the next 10 years.
Yeah, for the next 10 years. So they'll
wow.
probably
okay.
have
oh,
wow.
a
10-year contract.
Okay,
year.
Okay.
Is that the same thing they did with Australia?
I don't know if they did one. Because I think Australia was like a house show.
Yeah, that was
a glorified house
show. Oh, okay. Yeah. So it was kind of like the Beast in the East type of thing?
Yeah.
Where it was just one time thing?
Glorified house show.
Mm-hmm.
And I skipped that one.
What, the Beast in the East?
Yeah, that glorified house show with the
that's,
Beast in the East.
Honestly, that's what it is.
I watched it, but I don't really remember anything from it besides.
Just man, I just watched him. Yeah. I
just smashing Kofi randomly in a random match.
Yeah, I was like, what did this even come from?
Just random.
But they had to make that money.
Yeah.
As far as like, because like, I kind of like what they did with, Rhonda and the Bellas, and I hope that this isn't one of those things where they're trying to take the belt away from Rhonda to give to the Bellas, but to help push Rhonda, because like I felt like that was the best promo that she did Monday, and the way that they actually pushed that on her, and it seemed more natural with her, with that as far as what she's been doing in the past to that one. I felt like that one was the most natural of her, and she coming out of her shell. So I kind of feel like, in a sense, even though I don't really too much like the Bellas, I feel like they actually were able to push her to actually put out a great promo. Well, so what do y'all think about that matchup in the first place with Rhonda and the Bellas?
Well, I just saw a post from, I believe it was from the Wrestling Observer, and they're pretty good on their stuff.
Right.
They are not credible. Stop playing.
Yes,
stop
they are. Playing. What are you talking
they
about?
Dave Meltzer and Brian, no, that's Ryan Clark. But he just get his crap from the other people. Brian Alvarez and what's your favorite person? David Meltzer.
Well, yeah. I think it mentioned them in the post. But anyway, it was saying that she wrote that whole promo herself. Like, they didn't have a writer for it. She made some bullet points, and then she went off the bullet points. Now, of course, they had her change a few things in it because, you know, they're not going to let her just go out there.
Right.
But she pretty much came up with that whole promo for herself. And it was saying how she coined the phrase, excuse my language, but do nothing, bitches.
Oh my gosh, my ears.
I mean, we all know who we got watching, you know what I'm saying? So,
what about who we got listening?
You know, but she coined that phrase back in UFC, I think back in 2015 or 14, somewhere around that time. So that's what she was going to say, but they made her change it to Bellas, do nothing, Bellas.
Right.
Because, you know, PG, TV,
PG. Oh my
gosh,
she wrote that. I hated that line. I was like, DMB? It's like, what? Do nothing, Bellas.
I was supposed to be Bellas.
I mean, when I heard that, I was like, man, that's something Triple H wrote.
And it's crazy because I'm like, with the language thing, I'm like, yo, you got Brock. Like, Brock was throwing language, you know, like
man, that man don't care.
And I'm like, at the end of the day, I'm like, with the whole language thing, I'm like, so is it just exclusive to Brock?
Because Nikki Bella said it too. She called Maurice that.
And so did Becky Lynch. Charlotte that.
So maybe they were like, Rhonda's got to be cookie cutter good. She can't curse.
Then also, like, hey, when y'all go make the move to Fox, are we switching it up there as well? Because mind you, I think with Fox, I think they, you know, they let the S word slip out.
TV, yeah, they're starting, and I mean, this. I think this is just across like all TV channels, they're letting most words fly that we wouldn't hear, that we didn't hear, 5 years ago.
Yeah, I was like, but like the way you etch it out, mind you, we've been watching wrestling for years, so it's like, okay, to me, if Ronda does drop the belt, and then of course gets it in grand fashion, I don't have a problem with that, because like one thing I like about Ronda, at first I was like, oh my god, like, okay, get her out of here. She's really shown that she's a student of the game.
Yeah,
like I'm, each little thing that I kind of slipped up, I'm gonna work on it. It's not just, hey, I'm here for the cash, I don't care how I look, stiff, whatever, miss lines. No, I actually care about this stuff. So I like the fact that she's really investing a lot of time to bring out the best in her, because this is a whole new element. This is pro wrestling, not necessarily UFC. It's a lot of entertainment aspects in it. So the fact that she's really digging in, I like that. And then the fact that WWE is comfortable, granted, it's Ronda Rousey, they throwing crazy cash at her, but just to be able to be like, hey, we trust you to get lines and stuff like that, that shows a lot on her part. I think the Bellas, they're just, they always be perfect heels for me. Just a great heel tandem, especially WWE. They produce a lot of good female heel tandems, you know what I mean? And the Bellas are just in there, in that whole lineup. So I like what they're doing with Ronda, just because they're the perfect people to beef to me with Ronda, just because so many people have a hatred for the Bellas. Everybody really kind of rocks with Ronda, so I like it.
I'm glad you said that. People be hating on me when I give the Bella Twins some compliments. Yeah, they be hating.
Brie, mind you.
The weak link.
Yeah, I was just like, mind you, people go in on Nikki, but she's definitely showing a lot of improvement.
Yeah, I can honestly say Nikki did show improvement, but like in the past, like I always cringe when I saw a Bella match, because like you're not supposed to make wrestling look fake, and like every time I watched their matches, you could tell that it was fake.
Right.
And that's what I hate about watching the Bellas. And then for them to say that they started, like, there was so many talented, because, like, I've been telling people, I watched Total Diva. Right. And, like, I hated the fact that Natty basically kissed their asses, basically. Because I felt like Natty was so much better than them.
Right.
But she praised them for, I don't know if it was just because of the money. And they were like, these are the stars, you're supposed to praise them. Because, like, I feel like Natty should have got more praise in the WWE than she has gotten.
I think she gets the adequate amount of praise just because of what she's bought. But on the flip side of it, it's, there is a business, and I think the Bellas, in terms of on that other side, they've put themselves in the position to be kind of the female faces, charity events, we're seeing the Bellas. Natty, she does her thing as well, but it's just because she's more, focused on the technical aspect of wrestling. Mm-hmm. And then just over the years, she's developed, her character, given more of her personality. But just the Bellas, that's just kind of, mind you, total Bellas. Mind you, they've got their own, they got a spinoff, Total Diva. So it just shows like there's just, they got, you can't knock certain things, and they just got that certain factor about them that just people, kind of gravitate towards. But I think that Natalya, for the most part, just for what she's given to, the women's division, I think she gets her just due for the most part.
Because I think they can only push you as far as the fans will grab you.
Yeah.
Like if they
I don't believe
you,
that.
I don't.
I definitely don't believe that.
I do because Natalya's had like five times they've pushed Natalya. You put the Bella Twins there, they can just come back, and people are, when I went to Access, there was a billion of women dressed up as Nikki Bella. I didn't even see as many Brie Bellas. I didn't see a Natalia. Natalia is nowhere close to as popular, and like you said, I've been trying to explain the business aspect to wrestling fans forever, and they just can't get it. Like, you can push someone as hard as you want. Dolph Ziggler's had it. People are still not gravitating towards Dolph Ziggler, so Dolph Ziggler's not going to stay as a main champion if the fans aren't gravitating towards him.
Right. My take on that is I look at Zack Ryder when he got his push. Mm-hmm. WWE wasn't pushing him.
But they did, though.
After he did what he did, which was had his internet channel,
right?
Created his little internet championship. Right. And, you know, he built that himself. Mm-hmm. And then he got the push to the IC title.
But what happened after that?
They dropped.
Yeah, he died because the fans stopped caring. Vince McMahon
came. They put him in a situation where he was with Eve.
But they put,
Eve played him. And they fed him the cane.
Hold on, they put him with John Cena, though.
John Cena made him look like a fool.
But look, this is what I'm saying about WWE. When they keep saying John Cena's got the golden shovel. This is what I feel like. Let's say someone like Seth Rollins, and he's great and he's still up there. I can't think of another wrestler that didn't make. Well, let's say Alex Riley. Alex Riley, nobody, he was with Miz. No one really cared. They're like, oh yeah, he can be the future, whatever, blah, blah.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Then they put you in a situation to succeed. You don't grab those fans, so WWE is like, well, if he ain't getting the fans, what can I do with them? Then he goes into a feud. I don't think he ever did, but if he goes into a feud with John Cena wins that match at a pay-per-view. Fans are like, oh, John Cena buried him. Y'all didn't care about him anyway.
Big
Y'all
facts.
Only cared about him
Big
for that temporary facts. Moment that John Cena was in your segments. So I don't understand why fans are like, John Cena, the golden shovel, blah, blah, Triple H took out the golden shovel. No, he didn't. That golden shovel was already there. Y'all fans took out the golden shovel. Mm. It was not John Cena. Mm.
And I feel you on that.
I do feel you on that.
I just, for me, when I look at these superstars and the ones who
Ariel don't, was good though.
who don't grasp that, mm-hmm. hit that glass ceiling. Mm-hmm. I don't always think it's necessarily them. In a sense of, because for those athletes who are trying to hit that glass ceiling,
mm-hmm, right.
that glass ceiling, they're dealing with WWE behind them, still feeding them their lines, telling them what kind of character that they mm-hmm. want them to be. Mm-hmm. Let that person create their own character, mm-hmm. like what TNA did with Matt Hardy. Mm-hmm. Matt Hardy, go ahead. You know, they gave him full control over the Broken Universe, mm-hmm. Broken Hardys.
Yeah.
And you see what he did with that. So if you're going to give somebody the opportunity to hit that glass ceiling, let them build their own character. Mm-hmm. Let them build their own promos, mm-hmm. and see where it can go.
Actually,
because if you don't give them that opportunity, you're just feeding them everything that you want them mm-hmm. to do. If they don't like that character, they're only going to do but so much with the character that you're telling them to be. And they can only make it work for what they can.
But how long have they complained about John Cena, though? And he's still rising number one? And y'all complaining about him 2 years?
See, the thing about Cena was when Cena first came, when he first got there, mm-hmm. the energy that he brought with mm-hmm. him, whether people liked him in this whole Doctor of Thuganomics role or not, I mean, you can't deny the amount of energy and the star power that he had. Mm-hmm. Like, you looked at him and you're like, he's going to be a star. Mm-hmm. And there's some people that they just have that. And then there's people like when Daniel Bryan first came in, mm-hmm. you looked at him. You weren't looking at him like, oh, he's going to be a star one day. Mm-hmm. You know, same thing with him. He had to build that fan base. I mean, he got fired for accidentally choking out, what's his
Josh
name?
Josh Roberts.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, and then
you remember that
part? I just couldn't remember his name, but I saw his face.
Either. Now I remember the name.
You know, and when he came back, they gave him that other opportunity. Mm-hmm. And he came back, he still had to build his way up mm-hmm. there, you know. And when he came back, you weren't looking at him like, oh, Daniel Bryan's back, yay, he's going to be a star. You're looking at him like, okay. I mean, if you even remembered him, you're just mm-hmm. like, okay, Daniel Bryan's here.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But over time, he built up that fan base. Mm-hmm. And then with the whole Yes movement that came along with being with Kane, mm-hmm. I mean, that was something that they gave him the realms of building up your character.
Yeah.
You know, they still were just like, you know, do this, this, and this, but they gave him freedom to build that character. So he took what he had and he built that character mm-hmm. with the freedom that he gave. If I don't give you freedom, you're only going to hit as so high as you want to hit mm-hmm. in the character. If you don't like it, you're not going to go the extra mile. Okay. You're just going to do what you have to do to try to build your fan base, mm-hmm. but you're not going to go that extra mile to keep that fan base.
That's mm-hmm. true.
And if they put you in situations where you're consistently losing two big names, mm-hmm. like you said, people are not, they're not going to gravitate for it towards you. They're going to be like, well, you keep losing big matches. That's mm-hmm. like Chad Gable. Mm-hmm. They kept putting him in these big matches, and he kept on losing. He kept on losing. Now, Chad Gable, he's got real skills. Like, I look at him, I'm like, yeah. damn. Mm-hmm. Like, that's a good technical wrestler mm-hmm. right there. But they kept putting him in these big matches. AJ Styles, I think he had a match with Randy Orton. I can't remember.
That was just filming.
Yeah, but they put him in these matches, and he's looking good, yeah. but they're not letting him go over. Mm-hmm. Which I know if you're going against AJ Styles, he's a champion, you don't want him to lose to Chad Gable. Right. But if you're going to put him in big matches, he's got to go over at some point.
I know, but in my opinion, I feel like if you're kind of like John Cena, I don't even know if they chose him as the star or if he just became the star after the rap gimmick. But like John Cena, he wasn't really put in big matches. He did something to make fans gravitate towards him. And I feel like the people that are in the mid-card or cruiserweights, mm-hmm. I think WWE gives them a little bit more freedom to do whatever because they're not really focused on them. They're mainly focused on the main picture. Mm-hmm. So that's where their main focus is. And I feel like someone like John Cena, if he can bring those fans into him while he's in the little mid-card due to, like you said, the gimmick and all that stuff, there's no reason why Dolph Ziggler or others shouldn't be able to do the same. I agree with creative mm-hmm. that it is creative. That's the whole problem with the show, in my opinion, is creative. Because mm-hmm. like you said, they don't give them enough control to actually put out what they really have. Like they can't live up to expectations if they don't cut the strings. So I feel like they don't put on their best promos and segments because they're not really feeling it. And the crap I've been hearing for like 5 years, when I look at a grown man talking like that, I'm like, who wrote that?
Right.
Like, yeah. It is awful.
Right.
Like, and the women, I think they are worst.
But like, to go back to John Cena, mm-hmm. when was the last time you actually seen John Cena? Or when has John Cena ever really been in the mid card?
He was with Bull Buchanan. He feuded with Rikishi. That was way down low. Rikishi wasn't even considered.
But that was after Kurt Angle. He came in. His first match was against Kurt Angle.
He came in and challenged Kurt Angle in a different gimmick. He feuded with Kurt Angle again when he became a rapper. He first came, he was in like blue shorts. And he went against Kurt Angle for the Ruthless Aggression or something like that.
Yeah.
That was his debut.
He was a U.S. champ. He was in the mid card when he was on SmackDown.
With Eddie Guerrero.
Yeah.
It was.
I don't know if I call that mid card because they treated him.
But they didn't.
Yeah, I guess
that'd be a mid card. Because they had the Undertaker and Brock Lesnar.
Yeah, you got Taker, Brock. Edge around the time.
Yeah.
Rey Mysterio, you know, I guess this was like SmackDown 6 times. Yeah. So I mean, you know, and then also he even demoted himself, you know, when he won the U.S. title, I think. Two, three years ago when he was doing the U.S. title,
That was him putting himself there.
I mean, well, himself and also the company just, hey, like, we've got other people.
I feel like during that time, he was basically giving people the opportunity
to shine.
But I never really said that John was, what they said, a golden shovel and everything. Like, I feel like he really sits there and tries to help other wrestlers and stuff like that, because like I know, like, even though it's not really advertised that big, like, he used to help Big E out and everything,
right?
So
and one thing at the end of the day, like, yo, people are human, you know what I mean? Triple H has gotten that treatment, about, you know, having the golden shovel, like, yo, at the end of the day, sometimes I think in the business, people do what's best for business, but at the same time, it's just like some people, like, yo, I don't like him, or yo, he did something that just, hey, I'm gonna get him back, and I'm gonna, like, say something to, you know, management to get him get demoted or get them knocked out of a title shot or whatever the case may be. Just, you know, at the end of the day, whatever reasons may be, you know, because, I mean, I've been guilty of, you know, not necessarily knocking somebody out of place, but just being mad, like, hey, I'm going to say something, or, you know, so at the end of the day, I kind of like, but one thing about with John and just other guys in that position, it's like, hey, man, with great power, like Uncle Ben told us that, man, with great power comes great responsibility. Sometimes you have to do what's best for business. One thing I just, with John, I'm like, he dropped the ball with Nexus. I think that was just one of the things.
Yeah.
If he had that much power, I'm like, bro, at the end of the day, that was like the new, you know, that was a whole new movement, new energy that could have really took, you know, to new heights.
I read something about that.
Yeah.
This was like a couple, I think it was a couple years ago. He didn't want to go over in that whole Nexus angle. He wanted to lose to them.
I heard otherwise. Wade Barrett said that they told Wade Barrett that they were supposed to win. And then Arn Anderson came to him and told him he was going to lose.
Yeah.
And so Wade Barrett said he went to Vince McMahon, like, what's going on? And he was like, a kid's got to go home happy. And Wade Barrett wasn't feeling it.
Yeah, and that wasn't John Cena. John Cena wanted to lose to him.
Gosh, so I didn't hear about what John wanted.
Yeah, that's what I
was. That's just part of the story I heard was his, but I don't know who exactly made that decision.
Vince McMahon, because he makes all the decisions still.
Right.
But John, he wanted to lose to him. He didn't want to go over and that's it, and the whole Nexus thing. Mm-hmm. But they told him that he was winning.
Somebody else did that too. I can't remember. Another wrestler wanted to put someone else over, and the WWE was like, no.
That's funny.
That's crazy.
I know that they said that Brock didn't want to beat the Undertaker, and the Undertaker is the one that picked Brock to actually end his streak. And like a lot of people been giving Brock a lot of slack for that and everything. And like he was like he didn't want that responsibility. So because like a lot of people give Brock a lot of slack and everything. But like I use this scenario. Because, like, if you go back, look at the Andre the Giant documentary.
Right.
And how they said that they only had him for the big pay-per-views and stuff like that, big attraction. Like, I honestly feel like that's what they, like, a lot of people don't like the fact that he had the belt and he only defended a certain time. I feel like that's what they were doing.
Right.
Like, they knew that they were going to get a lot of views. Because, like, it's kind of like the Mayweather thing. Like, people watch Mayweather's fights, and he does what he does as a villain. Because people want to, they're going to buy the pay-per-view to see him lose.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Or see him compete. Right?
Yeah. So that's the same thing they did with Brock, I felt. Like, they knew people hated him so much, and they wanted to sit there and watch him for the possibility that he was going to lose the belt.
I like that concept. The only thing is it's a model that's, like, from the 80s and the early 90s of, like, hey, we only got 5 pay-per-views a year, so the champ's defending the belt big time, like, you know, back then it would be like, hey, you're defending it on, you know, WrestleMania, Royal Rumble, Survivor Series, SummerSlam, and maybe 2 Saturday night main events. You know, at the end of the day, you do, you know, run the house show circuit. But for the most part, that's the model I think they were going for.
But
it's like, y'all got all these pay-per-views, you got shows every week, like, you know.
But look at the champion that actually does defend it every pay-per-view and everything.
How many people value
the SmackDown champion?
Over almost it's crazy to say, almost like it's oversaturated, like they oversaturated because he defended on Raw pay-per-view, like
every
pay-per-view. And honestly, it's crazy because you know this is a conversation that people have had, especially being this in retrospect now, almost 20 years later, with the Attitude Era, man, because of all those quick title changes. You know what I mean? Changing on Raw. Granted, for us as consumers, that was a dope time because you know we could watch regular TV and see a title change. I don't got to pay pay-per-view. Bet
$50 to watch this.
Bet. That's cool. You know what I mean, that's dope. Bro just won the the world title on Raw. That's dope. You know, but it's like that really. Now we're getting the aftermath of what the damage of what that era did.
Yeah.
That was just like I said, those quick title changes of like every pay-per-view. Every, you know, you might get a title change on a show. And that just really, I felt like it hurt, you know.
I kind of like the concept of the Night of Champions where
dope.
All the titles are defended on there versus, like, like I said, it just seemed like it's just too much. Where right. every pay, because like now we have like, do we sell like two pay per views every month or just one?
No,
it's just one. It's just this time for some reason I got like 4 or 3 pay per views. Yeah. Like, in this month.
And then like this World Cup, like.
Why you gotta bring that up?
I was just like,
you mean the U.S. Open?
I was like, do they get a championship match?
Who's the only person in there that's not the best in the world?
The
I think Rey Mysterio is the only person in there.
And mind you, he's from Cali. You know what I mean? The roots is from Cali.
So. Exactly.
Yeah, I was like, so are they going to recruit somebody from the New Japan or something like that?
Right. The funny thing is, all the international people in the qualifying matches lost.
Yeah.
Rusev lost.
Shinsuke
lost.
You know what I'm saying?
And I know that they just, because I just happened, because like I wanted to watch what's that girl name, EST, on NXT. Y'all watch NXT?
I forgot her name.
I was trying to watch her, and then I found out that they actually have an NXT UK. Mm-hmm. So it seemed right. like they are branching out and everything. So they could have actually branched out to get some of their U, because they have a United Kingdom belt. So they could have got somebody from that division to actually just enter into the World Cup thing. It's like they just have all, because like the only new person there is, well, they have Seth and Miz. All of them all elite veterans.
But the one thing I have noticed about these, when they do these OT excursions, man, they're using, mind you, Super Showdown. Your main draw is Undertaker and Triple H. I'm like, what? Hold on, what? Where are we at again? Like, that's the main. And then, mind you, Crown Jewel, you're headlining with Kane, Undertaker versus Triple H, and Shawn Michaels.
That
goes back to what I was saying.
I am guilty for turning the TV when I see an old wrestler. I'm like, if WWE does not fix this show, no, I love the Attitude Era. When I see you looking like you just came up out of the rest home, you need to go back.
I'm not feeling
like
this.
I want to see that.
But that goes back to what I said. They're not letting these stars build characters anymore. They won't because they're so dependent on the Attitude Era superstars. Mm-hmm. They're not going to bring it back to Attitude Era. They're not going to let them have those type of matches. But keep using them.
It's my okay.
Sponsors.
And you really bring up one of the best points, the investment into the actual people. Do y'all even really care? Mind you, let's put this in perspective.
Break it down for us.
Think about what just this year in 2018, the feuds that we've gotten. All right, mind you, we got Shinsuke and AJ Styles. Mind you, in New Japan, they tore the house down. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? We get it, and it was all right. It was okay. Man, why did you do it? Mind you, we're getting some good solid matches from two of the best stars in the world. Mm. Then we're getting right now AJ and Samoa Joe. Like I said I said this on a group, they finessed the WWE into giving them money for a feud that they've already ran years ago. I'm like, these guys are geniuses, man. These guys are geniuses. Jesus. But mind you, they're giving these matches, and I'm like, at the end of the day, do y'all care? And sometimes I think, just as wrestling fans, and people in general, you can relate it to music, or you can relate it to whatever. Sometimes people just want to have something to say. Hey, I don't like how you guys are doing this. I don't like how you guys are doing that. I don't like how you guys are doing this. And I'm like, at the end of the day, we have to get back to just the appreciation. At the end of the day, with athletics, I don't draft the teams. I don't draft the players. I don't draft the players. I just watch what's being presented to me. And at the end of the day, in particular WWE. Shouts out to actually all the other great promotions that are doing crazy right now. Major League Wrestling.
That brings me to another question. Like, do you feel like they dropped the ball major with Cody Rhodes?
No, not at all. With Cody, when I look at his WWE legacy, of course, we all know he's coming back at some point, right?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So you look at his legacy. Mind you, starting off with legacy, he basically gets, and it's funny, actually, he starts with Bob Holly. the tag team with Bob Holland. It's crazy. I actually won the tag team belts at one point. But then you get drafted with Randy Orton, who's kind of, he was at his peak form. He gets his little subgroup. Legacy, you get your teeth cut doing that. Then you do Dash and Cody Rhodes. You know, then you do the whole face thing with the opera.
Before that, he teamed with his brother.
Right, right.
And then he turned into Stardust.
Right.
Oh, then I thought you were the mask.
Right,
oh,
the mask.
That was Dash and Cody Rhodes.
No, right. No.
Then he broke his Dash and then,
yeah.
Yeah, then he broke his nose and whatnot.
The Beast.
But, like, he's got, to me, a very good legacy. And I think the fact of that he went on an excursion, left, as most people do when they leave, you know, they get a new, you know, a new vibe about themselves, a new energy, pick up some new things, pick up some new mic tips, and then they bring it back home to WWE, and then it's like, okay, look at like Drew McIntyre. You know, reports is they're definitely really about to push him to the moon right now. And I'm like, look, you know, at first when he came in, he was a little, you know, mind you, he was going to get pushed to the moon. Timing, and what he, obviously it wasn't that time. Mm-hmm. He goes, does his thing over broad, does TNA. Now look, he comes back to the fold, and they're talking about, again, pushing him to the moon once again, but he got that time to really get right. So I think with Cody, it's the same thing. Mind you, I think Cody, he was not main event caliber. Yeah, you could have put him in a main event, give him a title run, but the investment wouldn't have been there. He's now made himself 10 times as more of an investment going, and then if he were to come back, people are going to, like, Cody's going to probably be, like, on the cusp of, like, one of the top guys in the company. As opposed to just kind of being like, hey, a guy in the company that they could use. So I'm liking what Cody's doing right now with the Bullet Club and just what he's doing with that whole American Nightmare. It's a good time right now, honestly, in wrestling. And he is one of the reasons why, especially after with All In. Like, All In reminded me of like when an artist says, you know what, I'm putting out my own album. I'm not waiting on a label, because him and the Bucks said, you know what, let's throw our own show. And basically, they went platinum. They went platinum. And they were an independent artist that went platinum. Because All In just, like, it did phenomenal numbers. You know what I mean? And that's just something that's going to basically reverberate throughout the rest of time now. Because now you're going to have guys that's like, you know what? Let's band up. Let's get together and throw our own show in our own venue. So, like I said, it's a great time, and Cody is definitely at the forefront of that right now.
But that, see, and that just brings it back to my argument.
Oh, my God.
No, it does. When he left, right, he had freedom to do what? His own thing,
right?
Create his own character and run with it. A lot of people don't have that freedom in the WWE.
Right.
So when they do leave, it's just like you just said, they're able to do these things and then market themselves 10 times better and make more, 10 times of an investment and make more money when they do go back. I mean, like I said, Drew McIntyre did it when he left. Mm-hmm. Cody Rhodes did it when he left. The Hardys did it when they left. And they all came back. Mm-hmm. Cody's going to come back. Like you said, we know that. And what happened? They get pushed to the top.
Right. I hear what you're saying, but here's what I'm saying. So I don't think you understand what I'm saying, Brian. When you put a wrestler here, let's say, I can't think of someone. I'm trying to think of a wrestler nobody cares about, but will swear they do. Finn Balor. Wrestling fans, I don't know if you like them. You put Finn Balor in the mix with whoever, and these fans are swearing, not Cody Rhodes, but Finn Balor is a great wrestler.
Right. Mm-hmm.
He's the bomb. He's this, he's that. WWE puts him there for you. I saw the match with Finn Balor, Roman Reigns, and not Jinder Mahal, somebody else. I can't remember the third person. Sami Zayn. Sami Zayn and Finn Balor are fan favorites. That's what they are. So when they were in the ring, after Finn Balor kicked Roman Reigns out in the barricades, the fans stood up. They were looking for Roman Reigns while your favorites are in the ring. Mm. And then Jinder Mahal comes out, interrupts, and need I remind you, that feud between Jinder, who nobody cares about, more so, probably more than Finn. But because Jinder Mahal is feuding with Roman, all of our attention is on Roman Reigns. But we're not talking about the people that we said we love to see. I want you to push that guy. And fans aren't even saying, oh, I think they're killing Finn Balor. what they're doing to his gimmick sucks. They're just talking about Roman Reigns. They don't mention Finn Balor, but yet they will say he's one of the greatest talent, but you can't tell me anything about him. You can tell me everything, the lines Roman Reigns flowed. You can tell me the wrestling move he skipped, if he's resting on a mat. You can tell me everything about Roman Reigns, but what about Finn Balor?
True.
Mm-hmm. If this is my favorite, if I am invested in Finn Balor, why do I care so much about Roman
Reigns? Because the overall investment is into Roman Reigns.
But it doesn't matter. You as a fan, let's just say me.
I mean, me as a fan, if I like Finn, I'm going to be focused on Finn.
That's what I'm saying. If I'm a fan of yours, Roman Reigns sucks. I don't care about Roman. When Roman Reigns hits my screen, I'm hitting fast forward or turn.
Mm-hmm.
However, when you say you hate him, but you're going to sit here and watch Roman Reigns, go to YouTube, hit dislike, comment a negative comment on his YouTube or whatever, and continue to make threads multiply just so we can talk about how badly Roman Reigns suck, but where's Finn Balor's threads? You're not invested in them.
That's
you're
true.
Invested in what Vince McMahon wants you to be invested in, but you're trying to go against the product, yet you're still eating up the product he's feeding you. Mm-hmm. You're just trying to pretending like you're rejecting it when you really don't. Because you've been number one in merch sales and a Twitter followers, it just don't add up.
Wait, like, Finn Balor's number one in it?
No, Roman Reigns is.
Wait a minute. You telling me something that I didn't even know.
No, Brian, I wouldn't lie to you. I mean, this time.
And I was going to say, I mean, I knew Roman Reigns was number one, but I was about to say, Finn Balor, wait a minute.
Yeah, I think it's Roman Reigns, AJ Styles, and the Shield gear. But yeah, if you're invested in somebody like me, I love Drew McIntyre when he was there as the chosen one.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody else cared about Drew McIntyre. This is why I was surprised when Drew McIntyre came back to a pop. I'm like, where were these people at when he was the chosen one?
Right.
Because
nobody cared.
That pop, most of that pop came from people who watched him in NXT. Because he came back in NXT.
Right.
And that's the thing about NXT. We all know NXT is
mm-hmm.
ran differently
mm-hmm.
than in WWE.
Right.
So, which is why a lot of the talent that move up
mm-hmm.
typically fall flat on their face.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not the same fans per se. They don't, you know, NXT has its own hardcore fans. Mm-hmm. So when Drew moved up, you had the fans that watched both of the product that popped for him. You had the fans that knew who he was
mm-hmm.
and liked him from the past and mm-hmm. popped for him. And then you had everybody else that's just like, who's that guy?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
We don't know him.
I still think he should go back to his old theme song.
That
song fits him so
yeah,
perfect now. Like back then, it mm-hmm. didn't. Like I loved the song, but it didn't. Like it didn't really fit him back
mm-hmm.
then.
Mm-hmm.
But it fit him so perfectly now.
But his energy is so different now than it was back then.
But
too.
His stereotypical theme song got to go.
But yeah, I definitely agree with that. But we all can look at him and say, he's got like a whole different type of energy.
He's more intense.
Exactly.
Like, he's more intense.
And people care about that because
yeah.
that goes back to if you come with that intensity,
mm-hmm.
you come with that your character comes with that star power,
mm-hmm.
people are going to gravitate towards
mm-hmm.
you, and they're going to gravitate towards you and that character, and they're going to like what you do.
Mm-hmm.
And if he keeps that up and he keeps those eyes on him, he's going to continue to grow in a company,
mm-hmm.
and they're going to eventually give him a run with the belt.
Brian, you better stop cursing.
I like Roman Reigns. I do.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't personally, and you're going to hate me for this, but I personally don't want him to have that title for a long time.
But who do you want to have it? Like, I don't care that people, like, say they don't like Roman Reigns. I don't have a problem with people saying they don't like him. My problem comes when I try to tell them the business aspect as
mm-hmm.
into why. And they're not really arguing with what I'm telling them.
Yeah.
I just feel like it's a whole bunch of so-and-so is better. Okay, that's cool. That's your opinion.
Mm-hmm.
But from a business aspect, he's making you money.
Like, I agree with you somehow. Because, like, honestly, I don't actually see anybody worthy of holding the belt right now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't really like, because I honestly feel like if they let Roman be Roman, he would be a lot better.
Mm-hmm.
But because they kind of, like, I feel like they kind of caging him. But, like, honestly, looking at it right now, I don't actually see anybody in the new breed, because like they actually said that Vince doesn't see any legends in the new era of wrestling. He doesn't trust anybody like carrying the torch. Yeah. And like, honestly, like, even though like Seth and Dolph, they always put on a great match and everything, I just can't, like, they do it with each other. Like, I honestly feel, I don't see anybody, like, I don't see anybody else, like, them put on a show with anybody else, and like, at the level, because, like, every time, like, you see them put on a show, it's like a tag team, they both have to be in it, because, like, that was an awesome tag team with, Dolph, Drew, and
not to cut you off, they main evented. They main what pay per view did they main event?
Yeah, the last man standing. You talking about the last man standing match?
That intercontinental title match.
I can't remember the pay per view though.
Yeah. See the
is that? But I remember all Roman Reigns.
Come on now, mind you,
I remember that.
But it's funny because Kevin Nash, he actually just spoke on this. And he says it all the time. And at first, it used to make me tight. You know, I'm like, why is he trying to go in on guys like this? But really, he has a point. It's just, you know, it's just straight. It's a straight shot, though. Like, at the end of the day, like, we you know, we're kind of saying it's just the investment with the characters. You know, back then, 80s, 90s, early 2000s, guys that were larger than life. A lot of these guys they're not larger than life, you know. Nothing wrong with that, but it's because of the entertainment aspect. That's what takes people far. John Cena, which I feel why he's been so successful, is because he appears larger than life, physically and just as a, you know, as a character.
Come off of as Superman,
right? I mean, honestly, you know, and that you know, hey, super, you know, that's just something that people like. Definitely with Roman, I feel like he's being caged in. I think really the whole roster, in a sense, is being caged in. One guy, though, but I mean, we are going in on the product, but also on the flip side, some guys that they're doing well with. I think one guy is Elias. Elias is definitely a guy that I think, like, you know, he really is a guy, a sleeper, a dark horse, because he is really kind of making some strides in other areas that a lot of guys aren't. Like that reaction he got when they were in Seattle with him and Kevin, and about the team, like, I've never heard that. And it's been a while since I've heard a boo like that coming from someone. So just that alone speaks volumes. That says Elias has got something going on. Mind you, this guy did an interview with Complex, but he's, you know, mind you, dropped the album Walk with Elias. It was like number 7 on iTunes. You know, mind you, we're talking about a wrestler. And again, it's those things that make people larger than life. John Cena, you know, he dropped the album, 2 albums, as a matter of fact.
He had that one good song. I just want to tell everybody that.
Actually, I'm not going to lie, it was a dope project.
And you got to think about, like, who produced his theme song.
Talking about John Cena?
Yeah.
Trademark, right?
No,
I think Word Trademark
Life?
For
you talking about Word Life?
No, I'm talking about, like, the one that he comes out to.
Yeah, he's like, I think Trademark produced the...
No, the same people that produced N.E.O.
I
knew that. Like, you hear that in
there?
I hear
Billy Dan's in there. And I was like, yo, that. But, you know, and I'm like, at the end of the day, it's like, John, I'm like, he rocks with, you know what I mean, with hip hop. So I'm like, I thought it was a sample, though.
Nah, yeah, it's the same. It's the same people.
That's dope. That's real dope. But that guy, but Elias, man, he's somebody like.
Yeah, it's crazy that the people that actually do have mic skills and everything, because, like, even, like, with Wade Barrett and stuff like that, like, the Wyatts, I'm talking about, thinking about the Wyatts.
Wade Barrett's still good on
mic. Yeah, yeah, but, like, it just doesn't transition into, like, the matches, because, like, even though, like, Randy Orton is my favorite, because, like, the way that he builds up his matches and everything is classic.
Right.
But honestly, like, because, like, when I got his DVD and everything, like, it wasn't, like, his match aren't, like, I must watch this over and over. Because, like, when I got, like, Stone Cold's on DVD and The Rock's DVD, like, watching their matches are classics. The build-up to the matches and then actually watching the actual matches. Like, you just don't have that. Like, you either good in the ring or you're good on the mic nowadays.
Right.
Like, nobody has that full package. And that's what's missing. That's why I said there's nobody really...
Social media...
There's nobody really to, like, carry.
The funny thing was with social media, they've utilized it to a certain degree, but they've dropped the ball because there's so much character development that can be used off of social media. Some people actually do use it. They stay in character and they might, you know, do promos and stuff like that. 205 Live is a place that, like, they utilize the cell phone promos really. You know, I like those a lot because it's just kind of like, hey, I'm in my raw element. You know what I mean? If I'm a heel, I might be in a spa, getting my feet rubbed with a robe on, you know what I mean, or something like that to really convey the message of, hey, I'm a heel, you know what I mean? And I'm feet, you know, like I said. So it's like opportunities with social media. Like, granted, you want people to connect with them, but also it's like, hey, you know, you got to, like, keep kayfabe up. Like, you know, hey, somebody hits you up, man, I love you. Oh, I hate you. You know what I mean? Ciampa, he does a great job of that. Yeah, he does a great job of that.
He says
Ciampa.
Ciampa, Andrade. He just came up from NXT like a couple months ago.
The Spanish dude? Is that how you say it?
Cien, yes.
I just say the dude. Yeah, I'm talking about more with Zelina.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just say the dude with
Zelina. Cien. I like him and also my man Tommaso.
I think they said they're actually going to try to push him. Like, there was some type of rumor saying that he's going to actually win the Royal Rumble.
He just does great work. And again, like, he's somebody that I could see that thrives, because sometimes, especially with certain guys, it's like you're trying to be too cool. So fans kind of do that anti, you know, they want to do the anti thing. And it's like, nah, I don't want you to, like me. I need you to hate me. And he's a guy that's like, you just want to hate him. You don't want to cheer him. Yeah, you're doing a good job and your character, but nah. Like, I hate your guts, you know what I mean, for the most part. But he's doing a great job. And, I mean, at the end of the day, it's NXT. So it's like, you know, for the most part, they're just doing a great job down there in general. If we could, let's talk about, like, the future, basically, of the, particularly WWE, because it's like almost like speaking death or something, but we are getting to the tail end of what I feel is Vince's tenure, and how I see it is just, it's going to be like a renaissance, because you think about right now in WWE, they have the best roster that they've had in almost like 25, you know, almost 30 years in terms of talent. And it's funny because it's the same process that Vince did back then when he just raided a lot of spots. Triple H and Code are doing the same thing now. Like, all these indie promotions, all your top stars, we'll just snatch them, get them, put them over here. And I think right now he's got basically a bevy of this crazy talent that's on deck that could probably thrive for the next 5 to 10 years. And he's got the best of the best of, you know, all around. You got Ricochet, Adam Cole, you got Velveteen Dream, who's more of a WWE product, but you got all these guys in NXT as well as on the main roster. And I think, like I said, once that Triple H and Stephanie to a degree era kicks in, we're going to see things, I think, that we've always wanted is going to start kicking into play for the most part. Like, mind you, with the women's wrestling, it was a point in time where it was just strictly, granted, yeah, the women had their division, but it was more like, it was a bunch of, you know, kind of Barbie dolls, you know, in a sense. Now we've got legit actual wrestlers, and, you know, we've got Mae Young Classic, possibility of having women's tag team titles. So we've seen the growth of women's wrestling just under this, you know, the women's revolution banner, how much that's grown. The cruiserweight title, that's back in the fold. That's got his own show. We're seeing guys, you know, for better or for worse, we're seeing Finn, Seth, we're seeing a kind of changing of the guard from what kind of what we were in a sense, the era coming out of. I think the future for the company is definitely bright just because they have so much talent that can lead them into that next era, just off of what I feel will be called the it'll be the territory era once times two. It's basically all they're doing is just raiding different companies, and you know, whether it be New Japan, sign people from there, sign people from Ring of Honor, sign people from Lucha Underground. I heard they're trying to get Pentagon Jr. and Phoenix, you know, from Lucha Underground. You know, so at the end of the day, man, they're just going to continuously, because they got the cheese to do it, scooping talent up. The only thing is just I hate seeing, like, right now, all these talented guys just kind of, I'm not going to say wasted, because at the end of the day, they're making significant money just by, you know, doing what their job is, essentially. So I'm not in the position to say, oh, they're being wasted, because I don't do any writing for any wrestling company. I don't do any. I'm just a spectator.
Because I know that, I forgot what year this was, but when WWE was in Greensboro, because they always go to the Hooters, and me and my boys used to always go to the Hooters and meet up with them, and I remember that my boy was talking to Eliza Burke, and he said, I'm just trying to get paid. Basically, he was basically telling them that you're such a great wrestler, they need to do this, do that. He said, no, I'm trying to think. Was it Eliza Burke or Shelton Benjamin? It was one of those two that he talked to. Yeah, it was one of those two that he would talk to. No, Eliza Burke, because now that I think about it, Eliza Burke was mad at him because, like, he was trying to talk to one of the waitresses, and he kept on bothering him. Right. So, yeah, it was Shelton Benjamin that he talked to, and Shelton Benjamin was just like, I'm just trying to get paid. Because, like, we were trying to say that he should be a lot further. Because, like, Shelton Benjamin used to be the highlight reel. Like, anytime they had a ladder match, like, he always did some type of move.
Him and Kofi.
It was Kofi before Kofi.
Yeah, it was Kofi before Kofi. But it's because this conversation kind of, it goes, when I usually talk about like that, usually goes to like the, you know, with race. And it's funny because, you know, the whole stigma is like, yo, okay, yeah, black dudes are athletic, but they ain't got no mic skills. I'm like, okay, I know plenty of like black wrestlers that like have great mic skills, and I'm like, okay, but they still haven't got their shot. And it's funny because I came to the realization a few years ago that like, yo, at the end of the day, there's not going to be a huge black star in wrestling because wrestling is a white dominated, it's a, you know, mostly white dominated sport. You know, at the end of the day, and that's just, it's predetermined, mind you. It's not just an actual athletic competition. It's predetermined. So I always look at it as like, okay, or when I came to the realization, I'm like, at the end of the day, no white man is going to write a black guy as just being, you know, the over-conqueror, the, you know, granted, you've got the, you know, you can get the sub, like, we could get a WWE champion, but you're not going to be the universal champion, the actual face of the company. And that's just, like, unfortunately, I think a hard truth, because I look at it like, yo, why can't Kofi be world champion? What else does he need to do? Why didn't she, you know? Why
put on some weight.
Right. You know what I mean? well, of course, you know, but mind you, Ray, he was, you know, world champion.
But on SmackDown, though. I don't think he ever held the regular belt.
The WWE,
right,
WWE
right.
Title? Because
it SmackDown. Was split.
No,
brand,
he
right.
did.
He did, though?
He held the WWE title.
Raw the, was he ever on Raw?
Not, it was... It was when Raw had the WWE Championship, SmackDown had the World Heavyweight Championship. He held it and lost it the same night to John Cena.
Right, to Cena after the CM Punk match.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Because Cena came out and challenged him and he accepted and everybody's like, no, why are you doing this? But then he lost it.
But I think it also comes back on the audience.
Yeah, but like, right.
Like Vince McMahon can, if because in my opinion, Big E, when he first came, mm-hmm. I didn't like that he was doing the whole Martin Luther King speech when
right.
he was first solo.
Right.
But mm-hmm. When they put him with New Day, I thought he did good. And then the promo, I don't know if anyone's seen it, with the Usos.
Oh, man.
But they were being like super corny.
Right,
and
right.
then Big E got serious. Mm-hmm. And I was like, Big E can be a world champion.
So
as far as going to Raw, but that also depends on the audience, because I don't really want to say the audience is, the majority of the audience is white, But I just feel it like is. I don't want to say that, but it's the truth. But when Vince McMahon puts like a white superstar in front of them, like John Cena, Randy Orton, or whatever, the audience gravitates towards those superstars.
You look just like me.
And you gotta look at it at The Rock. Like he wasn't considered black.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And like that's the closest that was the closest that we got.
Right.
We got Booker T, but Booker T was
WCW.
They were heavyweight champions.
The face of the company. Like, granted, we've had, you know, like I said, Booker T. You know, he had his run on SmackDown with King Booker, and he was world champion. Booker T just winning in general when he was in WCW. But the actual, hey, your face is on a cup, and we're using you basically. Kind of like with Titus, it's like, hey, we're using you for the promotional, but just like you're not, you know, but like, no, the face of the company. And at the end of the day, like I said, that's just something that is just a hard truth. Mm-hmm. Like, hey, you know, that's just what it is, but it's something that in the future I would like to see broken, you know, because at the end of the day, anything can be broken. I would like to see it be broken and see a guy who is actually at the forefront, whether it be WWE or any company in general. And shouts out to Jay Lethal, because Ring of Honor definitely goes hard, and TNA also went hard with him as well, giving him the world title. But like I said, the face of the company, like, that's what I want to see. A African American, I don't really like to use that term, but I want to see a person of color who is the face of the company. Like I said, mm-hmm. Y'all go to Saudi Arabia, he's the guy that you guys are using as, like,
you don't think Roman Reigns is a person of color?
I'm a part himself because he is a person of color.
Yeah, I'm kidding.
Sorry. But technically, because he is.
I know, but Samoan. Well, a black person.
Yeah, yeah. But
he, I mean, he, I feel
but
like.
But y'all think The Rock was responsible for why they didn't call him the first ever black champion? Because I feel like that was something The Rock came up with. Because Vince McMahon put him with Nation of Domination. So Vince definitely had to have viewed him as being black.
Oh, yeah. Because your pops, he was black, you know what I mean? Your grandfather's Samoan, but Vince knows the math. Hey, just a little drop, man. You're black. Just a drop. That's all you need is a drop. You're black.
He couldn't deny The Rock because back then everybody was crazy for him. Mm-hmm. So it probably wouldn't have been smart for him to never put that title on.
Right. No, I mean as far as they never refer to The Rock as
I know what you're talking about, because I think who was it that actually said
Ahmed Johnson.
I think it was Ahmed Johnson that he doesn't actually recognize his black culture.
Because I get him not recognizing it because he was raised by his mom, so his dad was always on the road, so he's probably more into the Samoan culture.
And then for the most part, I think Rock, at the end of the day, I'm like, what does he have to do to be like, okay, repping for the, because, you know, I think for just, you know, he's shown love to the culture, just in general. Like, I mean, when you think about it, The Rock is black culture, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, he is black culture just from the way he talks, dresses. Sometimes, like I said, going back to the beginning of the interview, sometimes you can be influenced by something and not even know it. Like, yeah, granted, he was raised by his beautiful mother, with, you know, a mostly Samoan background, but it's like, hey, dude, you got that soul, bro. You're not gonna be able just to escape it like that. It's gonna get embedded into you. Mind you, whether it be your hair, just your energy, your swag, how you carry yourself, you're gonna get that. And like I said, The Rock, he is black culture. Mm-hmm. Like I said, Versace shirts, you know what I mean? Talking land, you know, laying the SmackDown, just the verbiage, just hot. Like I said, just so, I think he's recognized. Like his heritage. I think probably they didn't want to push it because then you have to acknowledge it. Like, hey, this is the first black champion. Oh, that's dope. Hey, so why is he the first black champion? Why, you know what I mean? You have to actually face it. So it's just kind of like, hey, he's black. He's champion. All right, we'll just sweep, you know.
We sweep the blackness under the rug and we'll just go with the Samoan.
But I saw a list also that said he was on the top 15 list or something for celebrities you didn't know were black. And I felt
because a lot of people
don't
know that.
But I mean, when I first saw The Rock, I didn't think of nothing but black. I didn't even think of Samoa when I was a kid. I just thought a black man.
And I actually thought he was granted, they talked about Peter Maivia, but I'm like, I didn't know who Peter Maivia was. It was like the 70s, you know, when he, you know, when he was reigning. And I'm like, I don't know who that is. He just looked like a light-skinned guy with like a S-curl, you know what I'm saying? At the end of the day, but yeah, he definitely looked black to me. It's crazy, though, because shouts out, and it's funny, it's funny, though, shouts out to Ron Simmons, because he's actually the, even though he wasn't the first black world champion, he's the first black recognized via the big companies as world champion. It's funny, because then he goes to WWF, WWE, Nation of Domination, then here he is and goes and links up with the first black WWF world title holder. So it's kind of funny how like some things kind of come back full circle. Like both of them were in the same group and they were the first of, you know, a short list. You know.
But I want to say, to get back to you know you're talking about the future of the company,
right?
I also agree. I feel like once Vince McMahon, his time is come and gone, I think we're definitely going to see a change in the card. I think we're going to see the superstars being able to become legends.
Right.
Because, as we said, it's Vince who doesn't look at these superstars and say, I don't see legends. Mm-hmm. I don't see people who I trust who can carry this company. But a lot of them are coming out of NXT, and Triple H runs NXT. And when they leave out of NXT, I mean, you're looking at these superstars like, wow. Then they get to the main roster and they flounder. Mm-hmm. And that's like you said, creative. And that's Vince McMahon. And I feel like once that's gone and Triple H and Stephanie do have control over WWE, I feel like it's going to go into a whole nother playing field.
I feel like
we're going to get different matches. We're going to get better quality matches. I feel like the women's division is going to continue to grow. And we're going to see these partnerships with, like, right now there's this whole talk about the invasion angle coming from out of TNA. Because now, you know, they've bought some of their library and they've been having all these meetings with them. And even some of the TNA talent is preluding to an invasion at some point. So I think we're going to start seeing these partnerships. And, you know, we're going to see them do things with New Japan. We're going to see them do things with TNA and ROH and all these other companies. Whether it be WWE or it be NXT, we're going to see these things. Because I feel like Triple H and company, they're more open to doing that versus, you know, when this man, he just wants to beat everybody.
Right.
He just wants WWE to be the best. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's not necessarily about being the best. I feel like it's about giving the fans what they want. And when you do that, when we see like these companies like TNA and New Japan working together, TNA and ROH working together, and you got Chris Jericho's Rock and Roll Cruise, and he's got TNA and ROH on the cruise, you know, when you have stuff like that, the fans are going crazy because they're getting to see all of these different matches that they wouldn't necessarily normally see.
Right.
You know, so, and then you got people that want to see TNA and ROH up against WWE. Think about all the dream matches they could have.
Right.
You know, and when you get into that, and I feel like we're going to see that once the Triple H reign starts. Mm-hmm. And I feel like it's going to just be better wrestling for everyone.
I don't know. I just don't see the company going anywhere. Because I feel like they're getting too many wrestlers and ushering them in, and you're not working with the talent that you already have.
That I think is not, and pardon self, not to cut you off, I think that's probably also going to get to a problem as well. You got all this talent, and I think that's a problem that people kind of negate to see. Like, yeah, you got some really dope talent, but how's everybody going to be able to shine? Mm. Like, that's not how the show works. You know what I mean? This isn't everybody gets precipitation award just, you know, granted. And it's funny because in the terms of when they're putting together these shows, it's like each person has a part, whether it's the Ascension in a 1 minute match and they're getting, you know, squashed by a team. It's like that served a purpose. We might look at it as like, why the hell you got, you know, why are they on TV? Hey man, that's what their job is. The same way we've got that person in the background of a movie, their job is to be the person that's asked the bank teller, and then that initiates the scene. hey, that's what that person does. That, you know, granted, they probably could be an actor, you know, a full-fledged actor, do 100 lines in a movie, but we just need them for that. It's the same thing with the, you know, with the composition of with these shows. You know, each thing serves a purpose. But when you have too many people, no one can serve a purpose. When you got all these guys, you know, who's going to be the main guy? Going back to about a legend, I can't agree. I don't see any. I don't see a lot of legends on the roster. I see a lot of talent, and I see a lot of. I see a lot of potential. Like, you know, anything is possible at the end of the day. But, like, out of the, especially the new crop, I think, I don't consider Daniel Bryan or Miz a part, but the new crop, I think in terms of a legend, yeah, I could see Dean. I could see Dean Ambrose. He has a certain element about him. Roman, I definitely see Roman. I see him definitely leading the company, you know, into the future. Guys like, well, Drew, he's kind of a vet. I don't really consider him. It's a few guys that I'm like, yeah, these guys. Kevin Owens.
You don't like Braun Strowman?
Oh, Braun. I mean, it's funny because Braun is just like, man, he is really a monster among men because he is such that throwback of just really a legit monster. Like, not only is he a big guy, but he actually can work. Mm-hmm. Like, he's...
Because he did a comedy thing. I thought it was corny, but he did it well. I just didn't like seeing him do it. Yeah, but he did do it well.
Because it kind of it hurts the mystique, you know what I mean? But, of course, you know, at the end of the day, that's just showing a different element. Like, sometimes I don't agree, but I kind of see why they do certain things. Like, hey, we'll throw comedy in there just to show a comedy side of certain characters. Mm-hmm. Like, granted, this is a show of entertainment. This isn't a actual sporting event. This, you're here to be entertained. Mm-hmm. And certain times, certain, you know, they have to reach that quota of the entertainment. But just going back, I think they gotta do something in terms of with the roster. Like, hey, it's like, again, you got a guy like Finn Balor, who I've heard, you know, over months, he's lost in the shuffle and this, that. But at the end, I'm like, what could he be doing right now? If he is lost in the shuffle, What could he be doing right now that would make him stand out?
I mean, I honestly feel like with Finn Balor, it was mainly the demon that caught everybody's attention.
Oh, of course.
Mm-hmm. Because, like, when he won the Universal Championship the first time, I sat there like, how is he the first Universal Champion? Like, I honestly didn't. If he did not get injured, I honestly did not understand what type of direction they were going to go with him and everything.
We'll never find out.
And
but he had it back then before he got injured. He had a much bigger pop than what he has now.
But it was all because of demon. That's the thing.
I like that demon though, man. If I see a midget skinny dude in paint, I mean, that's not intimidating.
I mean, but I think it was like more the entrance.
It was just New Japan. It was just the New Japan, and the same reason why they signed, you know, mind you, they had already dealt with Luke Gallows, but the reason why they signed him because of the work that was put somewhere else. Most of the specialty guys in other joint, they've signed them because of the work that they put in. They just want the energy. Like, granted, we'll switch your whole gimmick up.
You know, Vince McMahon didn't want him. He didn't want him or Ken Anderson. He wanted AJ Styles, but AJ was like, we're the package. And you got to bring all three of us.
And I can tell because, all right, they, you know, in the words of Jay-Z, had a spark when you started, but now you're just garbage. Mm-hmm. Like, I look at the club and I'm like, like, dude, so much potential right there, like, literally. But at the end of the day, one thing that I've learned, patience is key. Things might look down at first, and then next thing you know, you got somebody, like, you're in a main program. You know, you're like, just like that.
Jinder Mahal.
Yeah, I mean, it happens. It happens, and literally, it's just all about timing, especially with wrestling. It's just like I said, with that actor. Yeah, at first they started off as an extra on set, and then they worked their way up to now where they're like the headliner. And I think that's just the same thing in wrestling as well. Guys can work their way up to where now, you know, with the right timing and the right situation, strike gold.
I honestly want to know how much truth is in the fact that they said the reason why Jinder lost the belt was because Brock didn't want to work with him.
I feel like they only they yeah, that was when it was supposed to
be. Yeah, because that was that champion versus champion match.
Yeah, that was that. Yeah,
I honestly think they put the belt on Junior because they knew they were going to be going to India. Mm-hmm. So they put the belt on him early to grab those fans, mm-hmm. those Indian
smart
fans.
Business.
And that's what that was.
Bret Hart lost to the British Bulldogs in England. Mm-hmm. You know, as they say, send the crowd home happy. Let's see. At the Super Showdown just recently, you got Billy Kay. And
Peyton Royce.
Yeah, you know, hometown. Mind you, they got the win. Mm-hmm. No, granted, I'm like, what? They actually won? You know,
yeah, and they had them losing mm-hmm. on SmackDown, the single matches,
right.
leading up to that. Weeks mm-hmm. leading up to that.
It's just, you know, that's a part. Kurt Angle beat, you know, winning the title in Pittsburgh and Unforgiven. You know, that hometown thing. It's just, it's one of those things that's a part of, you know, embedded in the wrestling culture, just making the moment even more big when you have something that's related to the hometown, whether.
I honestly think that
same thing on Super Show, Buddy Murphy. They
I think Bret Hart had in his I think Bret Hart had in his contract that he could not lose in Canada.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, I heard that.
Bro, I'm a Canadian hero. I think I'm really going to lose. Like, it's like with Hogan. Like, granted, yeah, I hate the politics that he pulled, but it's like, bro, I'm Hulk Hogan. Like, of course I'm going to have, like, you know, some type of control, you know, because that could hurt, you know what I mean, if I lose here, you know what I mean, in certain situations. So it's like, you know, like, you kind of, sometimes you got to flex that muscle just because of certain, I don't know, I don't want to, so for certain things, you just got to flex that muscle and be like, oh no, I can't.
They don't have that kind of control now. Back then, it was the same status yet. But things were ran differently back then. And that's the same thing, even in the Attitude Era, like I said earlier, they had, you know, Rock, Stone Cold, Triple H, mm-hmm. they all had more freedom and control over mm-hmm. their characters to yes. do and say what they mm-hmm. wanted. And
but they
now
don't
they
have,
don't. They don't
that's
have
because
that.
I think that's more due to sponsors that yeah, they definitely. Partnered up with, and then you have the PG rating. And if you believe that the majority of your audience are kids, you're just going to try to appeal more to those kids. Mm-hmm.
And the thing about it, that's funny. I was thinking about that. I'm like, yo, at the end of the day, why would they not appeal to kids? Because you got to think about it. All right, adults. Yeah, you guys have the financial stability to invest in us, but you got to think about it. All right, if you got kids, hey, the parent, you're going to keep doing what the kid wants for more years more than what you're going to do. Like, that kid is going to grow with us, be a fan the same way that the parent is if they grew up. So it's like it's a smarter investment to aim more for kids and children. Mm-hmm. Granted, like we were kids when we when we came up in wrestling, you know, whether it be a small child or teenager, we were still young when we came up. So it's I'm starting to understand certain things more on the business aspect of it. Like, okay, when you're going that merch table, it's kids. You know what I mean? They want to get that merch. They want to get those AJ style gloves. They want to get that John Cena chain. They want to get the John Cena shirts. They want to get the Finn Balor mask. They want all that stuff. And at the end of the day, the parents are just going to fork the cheese out. So I see now why it's, you know, granted, I'm an adult, but now that I have, like, you know, kids of my own, I can see, like, yeah, that's kind of smart because, like I said, the child is going to be a longer investment than the adult is. Because mm-hmm. the adult will just be like, oh, I'm not wrestling that wrestling stuff anymore, man. But the kid, like I said, they'll grow with it for about, you know, 10 to, you know, whether they be a lifelong fan going into that. So, but I'm going to have to actually, unfortunately, step out of the interview.
I was about to wrap it up. Can you give out your social medias and everything?
Definitely. You already know it's County Madison Jay. Please tap in with me. I'm not even gonna lie to you. I'm on Instagram heavy at the THE Madison JAY. Just search Madison Jay in the search bar. The kid will pop up. I'm on Twitter real heavy. The same thing, Matt at the Madison Jay. I am on Facebook. You already know. I'm in the comments below, so you already know. Just reach out to me, Madison J. I'm on all streaming platforms. Return of the Gap is the album. Right now we're pushing the Line 'Em Up single. That's on all streaming platforms. The video's on YouTube. Subscribe to my YouTube channel. You can literally have a YouTube and chill with my channel the whole day. I've got so much content. Tap in, tune in with me. It's Wake County's Finest, Madison J. And I'm glad and literally privileged to be here with such great people here at Quarantine Radio, man. Thank you guys for having me.
No doubt. I appreciate you coming through and everything. Yeah, because I was about to say, because we were way over anyways.
What time is it?
It's 10:45. But yeah, I appreciate you coming through and everything. Is there any date on like any new projects, or are you just pushing the single?
I'm gonna keep it a buck, man. I got a new single getting ready to drop. It's called Hot Shh, and that's coming within the next few weeks. So be on the lookout for that. It's definitely gonna be another banger. I think this is gonna be one of those, you know, one of those records that's definitely gonna bang for the season. And you know, I'm excited to drop it, man, and see what the world think about it.
All right, I can't wait to hear it, man.
Yeah, man.
All right, so make sure you all follow on Madison Jay on all his platforms. Keep up to date with everything that he's doing, the singles that he's dropping. Make sure you go to his YouTube, check out his music videos and everything, and like check out his camp as well. Cause like he said, he mentioned Roll On. Yeah, right. Yeah, I seen that video. That's a hot video right there as well. I know that that was another video I was asked to, but I think I was shooting that. I was doing something that week. Right. Like he had asked me to be in it. I was like, yeah, I got a gig that weekend. Yeah, I think I was DJing. Yeah, I was DJing that weekend and everything.
Right.
Yeah. But I like the concept of that music video as well. Shot very well, concept and everything, the club and everything. So I like that music video. Check that music video as well. Anything with what is the H Gang's official Twitter and everything?
The Twitter is HGS promo. The Instagram is HGS since 2002. Definitely log in and tap in and tune in with HGS on those two platforms right there. Also the YouTube channel. Subscribe HGS since 2002, man. You already know it's the H.
Alright. And do y'all want to give out your social medias real quick before we cut it out?
Sure. You can catch me at Creativities. Also on Facebook at Joy D's, and also like my fan page.
Y'all know what it is, King Cancer _ 1914, Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter, and my fan page is King Cancer
1914. All right. Real cancer. And trying to think. Wrong date. I was just about to let y'all know exactly who. Oh, yeah. We have the Future Assholes of America coming on the show next Tuesday. They're up and coming hip hop group and everything. I've been I seen them perform somewhere. I can't remember where, and I got connected with them and I invited them. They actually have an album coming out, so they're gonna come on the show and promote that as well. So check that out on next Tuesday. I'll let y'all know about who we're going to have on show next Thursday, Tuesday as well. And as always, check out CornyEnterprise.com. We got a couple things that we're going to start. I'm trying to get a actual, I've been saying this for a minute, I'm going to actually have a separate page for independent artists so you can actually check out their albums and music videos and everything. I just got to design that page and everything. So be on the lookout for that. We also doing music reviews, movie reviews and stuff like that. And also, the flag football team, the Women's Flag Football League, I've been taping them. You can all see all the game footage on there as well. They're actually having their playoffs October 28th. It's early. I got to double check because I think they changed the time again. But it's Sunday, October 28th. They're going to have the playoffs. It's straight through. They play each round that same day. So it's not like they play one game and then you have to wait the next one. So the girls got to go through the whole like a gauntlet of football games that that same day. So come out. I know it's Thompson Road. I forgot the actual numbers of it. But also, and as I've been saying, that me and I'm King Cancer, and you saw James and Troy Tuesday, we're actually trying to start up our own women's flag football team for the actual spring season. So hit us up at info@CornyEnterprise if you're interested. Any females that's interested in playing flag football. Other than that, y'all got anything else you want to say before we close out?
No, just follow us, hit us up,
go vote too.
Oh yeah, I'm actually going to try to do the early vote and everything. But Other than that, this show has been quarantined. We'll see y'all Tuesday.
Hey, this is Nola Aden. You are now rocking with Ill McKenzie right here.
Gabe, and I want to give a big shout out to Quarantine Radio. Make sure you check them out every Tuesday and every Thursday. And thank you for supporting my new single, Down Low.
I want to hear that you're so free wisdom on Quarantine Radio.
Yo, what's up, man? It's the kid Swiffer Baby, Young Swift. One time for the check-in with my dog, my homie, Ill McKenzie, straight out of ATL, Georgia. You know how we rockin' out here, baby. Let's get it.
I try to be humble. I try to be humble. I tried being humble. Humble get no respect.